आज भारत के प्रतिष्ठान की तरफ से डॉक्टर डेविड ट्रॉली जिन्हें हम श्रीमान रामदेव शास्त्री जी के नाम से भी जानते हैं, उनके उद्बोधन के लिए हम सब एकत्र हुए हैं। आप सबका स्वागत है। मैं भारत के प्रतिष्ठान की तरफ से हृदय से आप सभी का हमारे आज के वक्ता माननीय डॉक्टर डेविड ट्रॉली हमारे आज के कार्यक्रम के अध्यक्ष प्रोफेसर कपिल टोपल साहब का स्वागत करता हूँ।
तो ऑल ऑफ अस आर वेल अवेयर ऑफ द राइजिंग्स एंड द वर्क्स ऑफ डॉक्टर डेविड ट्रॉली। सो स्टिल एज अ फॉर्मेलिटी I'll give you a brief introduction about our speaker. Dr. David Trolley, also known as Pandit Vamdev Shastriji, is a recipient of the prestigious Padma Bhushan Award for distinguished service of the higher order to the nation, honoring his work and writings as a Vedic scholar. He has a rare gift. The highest accomplishment title possible in the field of yoga and Vedic sciences from Swami Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhan Sansthan, Bengaluru, the only deemed yoga university recognized by the government of India. He has a second gift from Ramana Lohia Power University in Faizabad, Uttar Pradesh, that was conferred to him by the governor of Uttar Pradesh. He has a special National Eminence Award from the South Indian Education Society affiliated with the Kanchi Sankaracharya Math, which has only been given to about 50 educators over the last 40 years. In India, Dr. Trolley's translations and interpretations of the ancient Vedic teachings have been acclaimed in both spiritual and scholarly circles. He has worked extensively teaching, writing, lecturing, conducting research, and helping establish schools and associations in related Vedic fields over the last more than 3 decades. He writes regularly for various publications and also active on social media in the last few years on educational, socio-cultural issues, and also on the importance of Vedic knowledge for the entire community. It has given him a vast and diverse leadership and following. Over the years, he has been one of the main experts in introducing Ayurveda to the Western world, as well as Jyotish, the deeper aspects of yoga and Vedanta, and the interpretation of the Vedas. Pandit Vamdev Shastriji's teachings are rooted in Vedic mantras going back to the Rig Veda. He is regarded as a master teacher of the Vedic mantras, their deities, and applications, and can share the ancient Vedic Rajyoga and its deeper sadhanas. Shastriji began his study of the Vedas in 1971 through the works of Sri Aurobindo and started to study the Sanskrit language. In 1979, Sri M.P. Pandit of Sri Aurobindo Ashram gave his support to Shastriji's work and personally was responsible for publishing dozens of Shastriji's Vedic articles and translations in various Sri Aurobindo publications in India, which occurred regularly from 1980 to 1984 in World Union, The Advent, and Sri Aurobindo's Exile. Pandit first awakened Shastriji to his Vedic mission and encouraged him up to his passing in 1994. Panditji helped publish Shastriji's first book in India, The Creative Vision of the Early Upanishads, that was in 1982, and serialized material from two of his other books, Self-Realization and The Supermind in Rig Veda, 1979, and Art of Yajurveda in 1982. So we are indeed grateful to have you here amongst us to We are very keen to hear your thoughts, though we have been reading your articles, your books, and listening to your lectures on YouTube. It's a great privilege for all of us in India, India Policy Foundation, and welcome. To introduce the topic, I request Professor Shankar Sharan to please come and give the introduction.
श्री अरविंदो ने अपनी एक बहुत आरंभिक पुस्तक थी जो महर्षि दयानंद के बारे में उन्होंने लिखा था, उसमें एक बात आई। उन्होंने कहा कि लोग समझते हैं कि ऋषि मुनि पहले भी हुआ करते थे, आज भी। उन्होंने कहा कि वो आज भी होंगे, और आज मुझे जो शब्द याद आता है राम स्वरूप जी और सीताराम गोयल के लिए, वो यही कि वो आज के युग के ऋषि मुनि ही थे जो काम उन्होंने किया और जिस पैमाने में किया, जैसे समय में किया और जिस श्रद्धा और लगन से किया, उसकी पुनर्वत्ता समय के साथ बढ़ने वाली है। ये आप आज की परिस्थिति में देख सकते हैं, जो लोग जागरूक हैं, जो उन विषयों से जुड़े हुए हैं जिस पर उन्होंने लिखा। स्वतंत्रता के समय ही जिस समय देश के लिए आजाद हुआ था, उस समय जो देश में वातावरण था, उसमें जो पीएम की कम्युनिटी की नीति बोलती थी, उस समय श्री सीताराम गोयल ने देश के लोगों को कम्युनिज्म के सिद्धांत, व्यवहार और उसकी वास्तविकता से परिचय कराने का दिया होता है। जिन कठिन परिस्थितियों में अकेले अपने संसाधनों से उन्होंने वो काम शुरू किया था, उससे जल्द ही उनकी एक बड़ी पहचान बन गई। आज लोग कल्पना नहीं कर सकते हैं उस युग की, आज से 3 जनरेशन पहले जब सोवियत यूनियन अपने पूरे भार पर था, वो नया नया चीन में कम्युनिस्ट क्रांति हुई थी और ऐसा लगता था पूरी दुनिया कम्युनिस्ट की ओर जा रही है। हमारे देश के प्रथम प्रधानमंत्री स्वयं कम्युनिज्म से बहुत गहरे प्रभावित थे, बल्कि उन्होंने काफी नीतियां उनके अनुकरण में देश में बनाई जिनका प्रभाव या दुष्प्रभाव आज तक देखा जा सकता है। उस समय उन्होंने जिस तरह के सैद्धांतिक प्रणाली की रचना की, जिस तरह सोवियत संघ के और यूरोप के महत्वपूर्ण जो ऐसे लेखक थे जिन्होंने उनको नजदीक से देखा, उनकी चीज उनकी पुस्तकों को हिंदी में अनुवादित करके लोगों तक पहुंचाना, कलकत्ते से वो करते थे। काफी समय तक उन्होंने 7-8 वर्षों तक वह काम किया था, उसके लिए पत्रिका भी निकाली थी प्राची, प्रकाशन भी किए थे और आज उन प्रकाशनों को आज देख सकते हैं, वो इंटरनेट पर मुफ्त पढ़े जा सकते हैं, आप देख सकते हैं 60-70 साल के बाद वो विश्लेषण आज तक वो सटीक प्रमाणित है और उस समय भी उसका प्रभाव महसूस किया जाता था। अगर आप श्री सीताराम गोयल जी की आत्मकथा पढ़े हाउ आई बिकेम अ हिंदू, जो संयोग वसत हिंदी में भी उपलब्ध है, आप उससे आपको पता चलेगा कि उस समय स्वयं प्रधानमंत्री नेहरू और उनकी कैबिनेट के जो भी पब्लिक इसके सदस्य थे, वो व्यक्तिगत रूप से नाम से सीताराम गोयल को जानते थे और वास्तव में उनसे थोड़े डरते थे। यही वो व्यक्ति है जिसने अकेले इस पूरे कम्युनिटी के उनका जो वातावरण था उसका वो अकेले मुकाबला कर रहे हैं और उनको जा रहे हैं, इसके लिए उनको दमन भी सहना पड़ा। बाद में पारिवारिक आर्थिक कठिनाइयों के कारण सीताराम गोयल को अपना काम बहुत लंबे समय तक बंद रखना पड़ा। फिर वो दिल्ली आ गए और जब पारिवारिक स्थिति और रोजगार की स्थिति सुधर गई, उन्होंने एक तरह से अवकाश लेकर तो उन्होंने फिर से यह काम शुरू किया लगभग 70 के दशक के बाद। तब उन्होंने वॉइस ऑफ इंडिया नाम की संस्था बनाई, असल संस्था जिसकी पुस्तकें आप देख सकते हैं, और उसके माध्यम से उन्होंने न केवल कम्युनिज्म के बारे में बल्कि सेकुलरिज्म, भारत के इतिहास का मिथ्याकरण, भारत के इस्लाम और ईसाइयत के क्रियाकलाप, इसकी सैद्धांतिक व्यवहारिक विवेचना और जो देश में जो राजनीतिक वातावरण था उसमें हिंदू समाज की रक्षा, वो इसके प्रति बहुत सतर्क थे और उन्होंने काफी प्रकाशन स्वयं भी लिखे, दूसरों को भी प्रकाशित किया, नए लेखकों को भी प्रोत्साहित किया और जिस तरह की बुनियाद उन्होंने रखी अगेन उनके समय में उतना महसूस नहीं किया गया जितना अब धीरे धीरे महसूस किया जा रहा है। और इसका सबसे एक प्रमाणिक उदाहरण यही है कि अभी जो अयोध्या पर सुप्रीम कोर्ट का जजमेंट आया, डेविड फ्रॉली जी ने इस बात को लोगों का ध्यान दिलाया कि उस जमाने में 1980 के दशक में आखिरी वर्षों में जब वो आंदोलन शुरू हुआ था तो विश्व हिंदू परिषद या हिंदू पक्ष के पास एक भावनात्मक तर्क के अलावा कोई विशेष बात नहीं थी और इसका इसका अंदाजा प्रतिपक्ष को इतना था कि वो लोग बहुत आसानी से इसको डिसमिस करना चाह रहे थे और जेएनयू के मार्क्सवादी इतिहासकारों ने और दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी के और दूसरे लोगों ने जिनका बहुत दबदबा था मीडिया पर अकेडमिया पर उन्होंने पैम्फलेट लिख करके विचार करके अखबारों में बहुत इसके प्रति एक भ्रम फैलाया था कि अयोध्या पर जो भी हो रहा है जैसे विश्व हिंदू परिषद और आरएसएस की बदमाशी है, ये लोग राजनीतिक गतिविधियां कर रहे हैं, वहां पर कोई मंदिर नहीं था, कोई राम और अयोध्या के बारे में जितनी बातें कही जाती है सब ऐसे बेकार है। वैसी स्थिति में सीताराम गोयल ने वॉइस ऑफ इंडिया के माध्यम से जो बौद्धिक डिफेंस जो उसका एविडेंस और बौद्धिक तर्कों का संग्रह किया आप उनकी पुस्तक बाहर देख सकते हैं, वो अपने तरह की मात्र पुस्तक है हिंदू टेम्पल्स व्हाट हैपेंड टू देम, उसका दो दो वॉल्यूम। इसके अलावा अरुण शौरी गोगार्डन्स स्वयं डेविड फ्रॉली जय दुभाषी एस पी गुप्ता इन सब लोगों को के लेखन को एकत्र करके उन्होंने जो एक बौद्धिक आधार प्रदान किया वह उसका ही नतीजा है कि धीरे धीरे मार्क्सवादी इतिहासकारों का जो एक तबका था वो बहुत धीरे धीरे कम हो गया क्योंकि उन्होंने उसका कोई उत्तर उन्होंने नहीं दे सके जो सीताराम गोयल ने वॉइस ऑफ इंडिया के माध्यम से प्रस्तुत किया था। और आप उसका मान इसी से समझ सकते हैं आज और पिछले 30-40 सालों से जो भी हिंदू आंदोलन के बड़े नेता है जिनमें भी थोड़ी बौद्धिकता है तो भी थोड़ा टच वितर्क और पढ़े लिखे रुचि रखते हैं उनमें से शायद कोई होगा जिनके घर में या नाली में वॉइस ऑफ इंडिया के एकदम पुस्तक न हो। यह एकमात्र रिसोर्स है जिसके बल पर आज पिछले 3-4 दशकों में हिंदू आंदोलन बौद्धिक रूप से खड़ा हुआ और इसको धीरे धीरे देश विदेश में सब जगह लोग इसको महसूस कर रहे हैं और उसको उचित स्थान भी दे पा रहे हैं। यह हमारे लिए बहुत सौभाग्य का विषय है कि जिस तरह से मैंने कहा कि वो श्री सीताराम गोयल और रामस्वरूप हाँ रामस्वरूप जी के बारे में कुछ नहीं कहा लेकिन मैं एक ही बात से आप उनका मूल्य समझ सकते हैं। डेविड फ्रॉली ने उनकी दो तीन पुस्तकों की भूमिका लिखी है और उन्होंने एक जगह लिखा है कि ईसाइयत और इस्लाम की जो सिद्धांतनिष्ठ विवेचना आलोचना रामस्वरूप जी ने प्रस्तुत की है वह पूरे विश्व में उसको कोई आज तक पार नहीं कर सका है। जबकि आप जानते हैं कि यूरोप में क्रिटिकल एनालिसिस ईसाइयत की बहुत लंबे समय से हो रही है कम से कम 200-300 सालों से। उस बैकग्राउंड में आपको ये समझने की कोशिश करनी चाहिए कि जब फ्रॉली कहते हैं कि पूरे वेस्टर्न वर्ल्ड में भी क्रिश्चियनिटी की वैसी समालोचना किसी ने प्रस्तुत नहीं की है जो रामस्वरूप जी ने प्रस्तुत, तो हिंदू क्रिश्चियन से इस्लाम और ईसाइयत को समझना उसको जानना और उसका आज के संदर्भ में राजनीतिक ऐतिहासिक और सामाजिक क्या उसका महत्व है इसमें रामस्वरूप जी ने सबसे बड़ा काम किया। वस्तुतः वो सीताराम गोयल के गुरु भी थे, उन्होंने शुरू के दौर में उनको सही दिशा में लाने के लिए उन्होंने प्रयत्न किया था और सीताराम गोयल को गुरु समान मानते भी। उन्होंने बहुत कम किताबें लिखी है लेकिन जो उनकी पुस्तकें हैं वो अनपैरेलल्ड। तो सीताराम गोयल और रामस्वरूप जी अपने युग के आधुनिक युग के एक बड़े ऋषि थे जिन्होंने हिंदू समाज के कठिन समय में बौद्धिक रूप से और व्यवहारिक रूप से रक्षा करने में एक बहुत बड़ा योगदान दिया और इसीलिए मैं आज के दिन को इस अवसर को बहुत महत्वपूर्ण समझता हूँ जब हमारे बीच में आज के लिए आज के दृष्टि से विश्व में डेविड फ्रॉली से बड़ा कोई हिंदू विद्वान माना नहीं जाता और उसी तरह मैं समझता हूँ कि अपने देश में सबसे कपिल कपूर से बड़ा कोई हिंदू विद्वान आज हमारे बीच में नहीं है। पिछले ऋषियों के बारे में आज के दो ऋषि अपनी बात कहेंगे और यह हमारे लिए बहुत ही सुख का अवसर है और हम आशा करते हैं कि इनका व्याख्यान हम सब लोगों के लिए स्मरणीय रहेगा। आप सबों का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद डॉक्टर शंकर शरण जी, आप एनसीईआरटी में पॉलिटिकल साइंस के प्रोफेसर हैं और इंडिया पॉलिसी फाउंडेशन की एडवाइजिंग कमेटी के आप सदस्य हैं, आपका समय समय पर हमें मार्गदर्शन मिलता रहता है आप लोग के। इससे पहले कि मैं आज के हमारे वक्ता श्री डेविड फ्रॉली को फिर मेरा आपसे पहले एक निवेदन है कि कृपया आपने मोबाइल फोन को साइलेंट कर दीजिए और ऐसी कोई इमरजेंसी नहीं होगी सवा घंटे का कार्यक्रम है उसके बीच में अगर आपके पास कोई फोन आपका मिस हो जाता है कोई मैसेज कोई व्हाट्सएप मैसेज होता है कोई बहुत बड़ी परेशानी नहीं होगी, कृपया अपने फोन को साइलेंट करके पॉकेट में डाल दीजिए क्योंकि आज जब आप हम बुलाया है डेविड फ्रॉली को आप कुछ कहना चाहते हैं आप सब लोग यहाँ सुनने आए उसके बीच में बार बार फोन निकालना मैसेज को चेक करना कुछ और के लिए ठीक नहीं लगेगा, निवेदन है आपसे कि अगर आप साइलेंट कर रहे हैं तो स्विच ऑफ कर दें। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर, रिक्वेस्ट यू प्लीज कम एंड गिव अस योर एड्रेस। नमस्कार श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। Well, it's my honor to be with you and to speak about two very important thinkers, gurus, and intellectuals of modern India. And I think a lot of what is going on in the country today, a lot of the gains that are being made, whether it is with the Ram Janmabhoomi issue or on many different levels, are at least to some extent, perhaps even to a great extent, owing to their influence and their effect on the mind of the people and the human mind overall. So what I would like to do is put this in a certain perspective and start off with my own background and encounter with Ramaswamy and Sita Ram Kaur. I was one of the young Americans in the 60s who took up the causes of yoga and which moved me into Vedanta, which was more unusual at that particular time. And in the works of Sri Aurobindo, particularly the Life Divine, I was able to gain entry into the Indian mind, you could say, and even to some extent into the Vedic world. In fact, I was introduced to Vedic knowledge through his Sri Aurobindo's Into the Mystic Fire and also Secret of the Veda. And in my studies, I've already mentioned about M.P. Mandir and also Sri Aurobindo, I came into contact, with deeper streams. And in my study of the Vedas, I could easily see that the Vedas had been interpreted wrongly, misinterpreted at a historical and cultural level. And it wasn't far from that to see how India had been misinterpreted from a cultural level. In the 80s, I came into contact with RSS organizations in India, quite by way of coincidence. My main Ayurvedic guru, Dr. Balabhashta, was a major journalist for RSS in Mumbai and Pune. He had been editor of Kesari. He had written a number of books, including on Savarta, Guru Gobind Singh. And so I was able to contact these Hindu groups directly before I had run into any negative propaganda against them. And through that, I did eventually come into contact with the Republic for 3 years with these mysterious figures, Ramaswamy and Sita Ram Kaur, particularly around 1989. And of course, we have the Ram Janmabhoomi movement going on very strongly. And also with the writings of Conrad Else, who was working with them at that time, particularly on this issue. And then I believe it was probably around 1990 or 1991 that I met them in Delhi.
And what I learned from that, my initial encounter, is, you know, I was always being looked upon as someone who was far too grown. And it was interesting to find people who would support that and also bring about a deeper understanding to that. And show a true and clear awakening of the inner mind. I had already written books on this Aryan nation and why it was false. I had already written some of the Ayurveda and Jyotish Veda. But with them, I found that more direct encounter with the inner mind. And one thing I had always had trouble with in my discussions in India was this idea that all religions are the same. In fact, even some people have told me, oh yes, you're coming in here very good, you can make you a better Christian. I already knew that being a better Christian was not necessarily any way of becoming, having a deeper understanding of spirituality or Hindu Dharma or anything else. So they presented a true understanding of Hindu thought, and particularly starting with Ram Swarup, there was the critique of the other religions from a Hindu point of view. This statement that, you know, misinterpreted Sarvadharma Sangha and misinterpreted as all religions are the same, it's caused a great deal of harm to the Indian psyche and to the Indian mind. Because if you, in the beginning, accept all religions as the same, then you disarm yourself. You don't have any critique against the missionaries, against all the distortions. You allow them to create a negative image of you, but you don't counter, and you don't go after their particular motives involved. Now, Ram Swarup and Sitaram Goel were a very stark contrast in some ways. Even in terms of bodily size, Sitaram Goel was so much more taller, and Sitaram Goel was much more outspoken. Ram Swarup was much more quiet, had few words to say, and yet his words had a tremendous impact. And what he brought about was a true and most authentic Hindu critique of the other religions. Not done out of spite, not done out of negativity, but done out of clarity of mind. In fact, he came from a Gandhian background. He was the main voice in India criticizing communism, which in the 50s and 60s was almost elevated into a state religion in the country. And Sitaram Goel himself had been a communist, and it was Ram Swarup's influence that brought him over to the Hindu cause. He had also explored the different religions of the world. Both, I think both he and Sitaram Goel had been involved with Swami Abhishekananda, who was a French priest who had taken over a kind of quasi Hindu monastic identity, later on called the Methodist came out of that movement also. But they saw the contradictions and to some extent the hypocrisy in that movement that would outwardly use the symbols of Hinduism but never give up this converting of people to Christianity that would speak of the greatness of Hindu gurus extending to Ramana Maharshi, but not go against the agenda of the church involved. So he made efforts to communicate with all these people, and he also found out where they were coming from. He also, they were engaged with some dialogue with the Sufis, and I remember one remark that I think it was that Ram Swarup made, having discussion of the unity of religions with the Sufis, and he said, the Sufis said, all religions are one in Islam. That is what we need to accept. So they explored this, and Ram Swarup brought out what is really a tremendous and central insight that must be born in mind. In Hindu and in Buddhist thought, there is, of course, a deep tradition of meditation and a study of levels and states of consciousness. There is not just the ordinary state of human mind and some state of self-realization, God-realization, whatever else you may want to call it. There are many other states of
the human mind. So let me go into this in some detail. Now, another thing that had attracted me about the Ramsar Root Sage approach, they were very closely connected to the teachings of Sri Aurobindo. And Sri Aurobindo had a much more Kshatriya model for India. And he had this, brought out this need for a deeper self-assertion, deeper understanding, and reclamation of Vedas. One of the main disciples, or at least followers of Sri Aurobindo, was another great thinker called Sri Anuman, and Harishchandra, who is here, has been publishing his works, particularly his important Veda Mimamsa. And I also knew Anuman's work. And so what Ramsarup did with their work, he said, look, we have to use this critique of states of consciousness to examine Christianity and Islam. If we go back to the Yoga Sutras, yoga is defined, of course, as samadhi, chitta-vritti-nirodha. But Vyasa, commentating on the Yoga Sutras, says that samadhi exists at all levels of the mind, all five chitta-vrittis. Yoga is only concerned with the samadhi of the ekagra and the nirodha vrittis, the higher vrittis, but it exists on the other levels as well. And Swami Vivekananda made a very important statement. He said that an untrained person can fall into a state of samadhi for various reasons. They can have a tremendous influence upon the world here, but there will be something tainted, mixed with rajas and tamas along with their experience that can cause a lot of confusion and even delusion as well. And Vivekananda then pointed out Muhammad as an example of that for all the good he did to humanity, and so also for all the problems that arose from the forces that he set in motion, or the forces that came in motion out of Islam. And if we look at the Western religions, we find that there is not that clarity of chitta shuddhi, purification of consciousness, and there's not that understanding of states of consciousness. We have religions based upon faith and belief. In the Gita, speaking of Shraddha, which we can roughly equate with faith, is also described as sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic. Faith is not always a good thing. There's blind faith. And faith does not put things beyond question. And as a little sidelight, I've been involved in a number of interfaith conferences. And one thing I noticed is you cannot question anybody's faith. And that an interfaith conference is kind of getting together to affirm everyone's faith. So joking that I've said that an ordinary person may believe in one irrational faith, but in an interfaith movement, you have to accept everybody's irrational faith. So belief in the Yoga Sutras in that tradition is vikalpa, as an imagination. You know, we talked about nirvikalpa samadhi, because one has to move all the imaginations and distortions. Now, looking at these states of consciousness then, what kind of state of consciousness does, as Ramsarup discusses, Jehovah represent in the Bible? You have a jealous God. You have a God who gives commandments, who has chosen people. At least this is how it is most commonly understood. We are also confronted with a psychic formation that is not purely subject. And in the Abrahamic traditions, there is not a concept of Atma, self-realization. There's a concept of Ishvara as a kind of cosmic word, but that Ishvara can be a very partisan figure and can have some very human emotions. Even the Jewish scholars today admit that and say that not only has humanity evolved over time, God has also evolved over time, and has hopefully gotten better in the process. So when we promote a belief, what are we doing? We want to convert and conquer the world. We want to save others. We want to save the world. These are motivations born of Rajoguna, not Sattva-guna. They are often connected to a militaristic frame of mind, control, conquest. And so violence, suppression, comes out of that rejecting of other forms of belief. Now, one could say there are mystics in Christianity and Islam, Sufis, for example. Some have said that Jesus was a yogi. I'm not going to go into the arguments involved there. But the fact is that the mindset, the psyche, the psychic influence that's coming out of these traditions lacks proper introspection, to put it in diplomatic language. Instead of examining ourselves, there is the need to control and conquer the other. So Ramaswarup brought out this critique. He also explained the states of consciousness as per what Sri Anandam had brought out, Yoga Sutras, Vedas, Upanishads, all of that. But theology does matter. And if you're following a theology that does not have this deeper insight, way of self-knowledge, then that theology can set in negative forces. Because religion is a field where absolutes come into play. And if you make absolute what is relative, chosen people, last prophet, only son of God, this language is itself ahamkarika. It has a certain egoistic trend to it. And then it develops an exclusivism. Recently, I was writing something about multiculturalism. That's also something I think Bill Bob's really would find very interesting. Multiculturalism, when you bring in an exclusive culture, you're actually destroying multiculturalism. Like an ecosystem in which you bring in an inappropriate a species that destroys the rest. So, what modern Hinduism has been lacking, along with its critique of other religions, is Vedanta, or a deep level of discernment based upon the teachings. In India, a good and a bad can happen, in that you have the independence movement. The independence movement came out of what's essentially a Hindu awakening, whether it was through Ramakrishna, whether it was through Swami Dayananda, Saraswati, and so forth. But when it became a political force, it had to then give respect to all the other religions. So any critique of the other religions came to an end. And at the same time, the other religions' critique of Hinduism could continue. Your heathens, your kafirs, your idolaters, your animists, you worship gurus and godmen, all these different things. So he brought that discrimination and discernment back. And of course, it does raise questions. Just as calling Hindus heathens or kafirs raises questions. Even when, from a Hindu point of view, we may question the level of consciousness or awareness of Muhammad or anyone else in these traditions, raises questions. At the same time, the Hindu tradition is not aggressive. But at the same time, it has the right to defend itself. If you are seeking to convert us and our children, we have a right to question your motives, your theologies, and even your leaders. Because you're the one that said, we have to do this because our leader, our savior, our prophet said that all human beings must do this. So this science of consciousness is not there in the other religious traditions of the world. And interestingly, I've also studied Buddhism to some degree. And I had a friend who was a professor of Buddhism at San Francisco State College. And one of the texts he was going through was called the Sharangama Sutra. And the Sharangama Sutra also outlines the different false samadhis or illusory states of consciousness that can occur. He actually came from a Jewish background, but he made the remark that this sounds like some of the religions of the world, but outside of the traditions. So then there has been this study that's going on from the psychology of prophethood. In fact, the psychology has been used to approach religious beliefs throughout the world. I wouldn't necessarily endorse Western psychology in that regard, but there is a need to look at the states of consciousness involved. And if we want an authentic dharma, there has to be a proper understanding of moksha, jnana, paramatma, jivatma, karma, and viva. Some people say all religions are the same, but then all religions don't have karma. Is karma something dispensable that you can make? And we have the other problem, which they also challenge, of using this Western theological terminology to approach a new dharma. For example, some people were saying that at the Kumbh Mela, Hindus were taking a bath in the river to get rid of their sins and achieve salvation, possibly, or heaven knows. So this terminology has also served to disarm the Hindu world. Now, I'm not saying we should be bigoted. I'm also not saying that freedom of religion should not be there. But we require the same viveka or discernment relative to religion and spirituality, even more so, because this is a crucial area of absolutes, as we do for any other aspect of human life, whether it's politics, whether it's economics, whether it's the people we meet, all of that. And Brahms Room and Sita Brahm go brought that back. Now, it's also interesting to note that when we make all religions the same, we not only disarm the Hindus, we also discredit the pagan, native, and indigenous traditions throughout the world, who are similarly being attacked and targeted for conversion, and have been for centuries. Just as Hindu thought has been denigrated as something backward, primitive, even idolatrous, even though they're borrowing from it. So too that happened throughout the world. Recently we were in Mexico, and you know, when the Spanish came, they burned all books of the Mayas, except for three. And in those three books, we find the most sophisticated astronomy, cycles and periods of Mercury, the most sophisticated astronomy, much of which they didn't even have in Europe at that particular time. And yet we were told that they were primitive people. We also have an awakening of pagan thought and groups throughout Europe, including whether it's Celts, whether it's the Germanic groups, whether it's the Slavic groups, Lithuanians, so many groups are doing that. And we say all religions are the same, we also discredit them. So Ramsarup had an outreach to the pagan traditions. He had a dialogue with them, and he also encouraged them to study and be faithful to their traditions and develop their own critiques of Christianity. You know, we are all kind of in the world, we've been in awe of Western civilization over the past few centuries, right? Mainly because of science, democracy, certain aspects of art, and technology. And yet if we look at historically, all these main trends that we admire in Western thought had pagan roots. They weren't products of the Bible. They were imposed by the Christian church. They came out of the Greco-Roman background, or even the Celtic background prior to Christianity. And even what we call philosophy and theology and mysticism in both Christianity and Islam has strong pagan roots. Catholic theology goes back to Aristotle. The mysticism goes back to Plato and Plotinus. Or there was a figure named Apollonius of Tyana, who is sometimes confused with Jesus. He performed miracles, and he was historically known to have gone to India and come back. Recently, someone asked one of the few Christian theologians, I don't think it was the Pope, but somebody else,
that, what do you think of Aristotle, who was the pagan? He said, no, he was not a pagan, he was a premature Christian. So Ramsu also reached out to that community and helped revive that community and give them a sense of support from India. You have to understand that Hinduism is the third largest of the religions of the world today, only after Christianity and Islam. It is also the largest of the non-Abrahamic traditions, the non-monotheistic traditions. And so it carries on the same aspiration of the pagan and also the indigenous peoples. In New Mexico, we also have a lot of the Native Americans there, including the Navajos. We have some Navajo friends. They live in a village of about 3,000 people. They still don't have adequate water and electricity because they're Native Americans, even though they live in the United States. And so I asked them, our missionaries targeting you? He says, well, in our community of 3,000 people, there are 19 different missionary organizations active even today. They're targeting their children. And we do not always know how to counter them because they claim to represent a more enlightened, a more humane, compassionate, philosophical tradition. Of course, we see that going on in India today. So Ramsu and Sitaram Goel not only defended those traditions, they also raised the critique against the missionaries and the Islamists in India at a time when it wasn't politically correct to do so. I don't know if it's politically correct to do so today. But we need a free and open discussion. And if we look at some of the evangelical groups with their fake miracles and their kind of healing and rolling on the floor and all the other things that they do, that's another, can also be easily understood according to this other states or altered states of consciousness in which you are motivated by a belief rather than an open pursuit of truth. If you're motivated by belief, then you're always going to do whatever you do, the mind can say, any trick to promote and uphold that belief. So over that whole era of all religions being equal and the same, Hindus were disarmed. And Hindus had to be rearmed again. And Ramsuru and Sitaram Goel, you have to remember, were a couple of individuals. They did not have the support of a vast organization. In fact, they did not have political support. In fact, there's a lot of political, media, and social influences against them just for raising questions. As you well know, that when Sitaram Goel produced his book on the Hindu temples, quoting Islamic records, he was called bigoted for showing what they had said. He was arrested, he was, he had a lot of trouble he was put into just for exposing what the truth was. And that took a lot of personal courage. And also, they did so without having any great financial resources behind them. In fact, they told me the story once. There was a lady, I think his name was Miramanda, from the Week, one of the Indian writers on the left. I think she's still fairly active today. So when we started writing these books in the 90s, they started attacking us. After I wrote one short book I did for Voice of India, was Myth of the Awakening Nation, which was a summary of the challenges to that long view that we had brought out. And I found that right away, I was labeled in the Week by Ms. Miramanda as a well-known fascist William Drawyer. Of course, they didn't get my first name right, but I was a well-known fascist. So we see, of course, RSS was dealing with that through all those periods of being called Gandhi killers, Savarkar being a fascist, and every possible distortion that had no basis in actual fact, but could be sustained because of a certain political, media, and academic support. So they bore the brunt of that attack at a time when very few people were writing One thing I can say today quite happily is we have a lot of good writers, a lot of young writers who are following the same themes that Ram Swarup and Sita Ram Goel put in motion. I won't mention all of their names. I have to be careful with names because someone will feel like that somebody else helped. But we have a new generation that way. And we also have a social media that can challenge the mainstream media, which can put out, which had a monopoly. They whatever distortion they wanted as truth. We also have alternative movements in academia. Academia also remains a realm in which these false views have been enshrined. For example, we know how in accounts of history books that Christianity and Islam come off a lot better sounding than Hinduism or even Buddhism, even in these textbooks of India. One of the things I can feel proud about in my life is that we have been challenging this Aryan question. And someone I knew had been on a plane with Romila Popper, and she was discussing how these writers from Voice of India had ruined her life. So there was that impact. So Nirananda came to Voice of India and asked, you know, where are you getting all your money and how do you function and what do you do? She thought that there was some tremendous resources behind it. It was the strength of the ideas and the insights. It wasn't just a question of having a big popular publishing company with wide outreach. It was mouth to mouth and smaller groups and to some extent influential people. Another group I have been closely connected to is the Hinduism Today Monastery and Publication coming out of Hawaii in the United States. They have some of the best books on what is Hinduism, and also they have an ongoing magazine. Now they have very good videos. For example, one simple thing they did relative to this, all religions are the same, they simply did a comparison. They had a page for each religion, what it believes in, what its values are, what its ideas are, its values, etc. So you just read through and see how much the same they actually are. And I have to tell you that one of their main inspirations was Ram Swarup and Sita Ram Goel. They wrote special articles on them, including at their passing. Main Guru Shivaya Subramanya Swami. And they have been the dominant voice of Hindus in the West. And they have kept up very closely with this critique of other religions because they have to see that. The young Hindu in the West is going to be confronted with dozens of attempts to convert them throughout their lives. And even it's very interesting, you know, I live in New Mexico, and we have a house up in the mountains, a relatively remote area. And once in a while, some missionary groups have come. We just didn't ignore them. But one morning, I went down to my gate. We have a gate so people can't go. And I found from the Jehovah's Witnesses a whole set of literature in Hindi on why Hindus should become Christians. And this is in the United States. So don't think that you are making inroads with these people by not having a critique in return. I tried to be friendly, or I tried to be open. I said, look, let's, spirituality should be like a science. Law of karma and heaven and hell cannot both be true. And of course, they will agree, but they will have a different understanding of it. We have to introduce introspection. And now, of course, in India, too, we also have the adaptation or acculturization process going on. And Ram Swarup and Sita Ram Goel spoke about that very clearly in the beginning. That is when groups, particularly the Christian and Catholic Church, adopts the symbols or terms of another religion, but for conversion purposes. Going in the South today, recently in Kerala, you have the stumpers in front of the church. They will do art. You may find Mother Mary with Ganesha. You may have the eight-armed Jesus. They may say, Jesus is a yogi, and if you become a Christian like us, you become a better yogi. So they were using that terminology. Even Vedanta I was telling some Hindus that, you know, why are you using the term God? It's better to use the term Paramatma. A couple of years ago, we were staying in a hotel, and they were having a Christian group was having a mass outside. Instead of using the term God, they used the term Paramatma. Although, of course, they were using it in a different way than the Hindu teachings of the Vedanta would have. Because, of course, for them, Atma is not a name of the divine. Atma self is not something they recommend. So that acculturalization we expose. And then all these problems happen. There was another friend, Devananda, was in a debate with Father B. Griffiths in South India, who was taking over the Shanti Ketan Abhishekananda. And he had Om on his cross, he had Om on the cross that he was at. And he was also still converting Christians. So the Swami, who was actually a Canadian, criticized him for that and said, you have no right to take over Hindu symbols. He says, no, Om is not a Hindu symbol, Om is universal. He was Buddhist user, so I have right to use it too. And they had a debate, and in that debate, which went to the media, the Hindu Swami was said to be intolerant and bigoted for questioning the Christian monk for using Om on the cross, and they never mentioned the conversion going on in that name. So Ram Swarup and Sitaram Goel also exposed that whole process of acculturalization. Just because these groups are taking on Hindu terms and practices, that doesn't mean they're honoring. In fact, it was also said that they wanted to do with the Hindus what they had done with the ancient Greeks. Take over their philosophy, their art, their mysticism, but use it for the church, and then eventually, of course, eliminate it altogether. Now in South India, we have Christian Bharatanatyam, we have Christian Ayurveda, we have bhajans where Krishna's name is removed and Jesus is used instead. That whole process of acculturalization is going on. And there, we can also see the alliance of the anti-Hindu forces. South India is the only place I know in the world where you can see communists, Islamists, evangelical Christians, and Dravidian nationalists all together as if they share a common religion or ideology. What they have in common is this wanting to remove the Hindu, but because the Hindu culture is so strong, they have to try to subvert it. You have huge seminary groups in Bangalore that are studying Vedanta and all the Advaitic gurus, not because they want to follow that tradition, but because they want to learn that language to better convert Hindus. This is an old practice. Jesuits always did that wherever they went. And then what we have to understand is that in the level of philosophy and theology, none of these groups can compare with the Vedanta. Logically, experientially, they can't. So they have to create distortions or beliefs, or they have to create social benefits, money, schooling for your children, all these other factors. So Ram Swarup and Sitaram Goel exposed that. And relative to Islam, they warned about Islamic terrorism before it had totally raised its face as an outcome of the exclusivist way of thought. And it's interesting, another friend of ours who worked closely with Voice of India was N.S. Rajaram. And one book he found was by Brigadier General Malik of the Pakistan Army. I think it was called The Islamic Art of War. And it had a foreword by General Zia. And in the foreword, they explained that the most important thing to start off with in war was terrorism. Because once you've undermined the confidence of the masses, then they're more easy to attack and overcome. And then we have the historical, right? It started off with this whole question our invasion and all of that. And Voice of India then also became the main company that was bringing out books like Elston and Talibari addressing these issues as well. Why was this issue so politicized? I always wondered that. And the reason is very simple, because this historical issue sets the foundation for interpreting the whole history of India and the culture. So after independence, we had the old independence movement, the old Gandhi Congress was thrown out. The independence leaders were discredited or forgotten. And we had the new Nehruvian Congress, who outsourced its intellectuals to the Marxists, who then rewrote history to undermine the sense of any cultural identity or continuity in the Indian context. And Ram Swarup and Sitaram Bose also wrote in a way to affirm that continuity and expose those distortions. They did a little more work in the medieval era, where we had all these groups like the Delhi Sultanate, besides the Mughals, whose work was to destroy the civilization. It was to destroy and convert. It was totally out in the open, and yet it was being covered over from the historical standpoint. And we have also seen that discourse turning in our favor, whether it was the discovery of the Saraswati River. And recently, moving kind of a little bit beyond that topic, I've been in dialogue with the geneticists working in the Niraj Rai and Vishinde, and they have now done extensive genetic work on hundreds of skeletons throughout India and at different periods of time. Not all of this work has yet been released. Some of it has come out relative to Rocky Gari, but it can now be genetically proved, even the Western geneticists are accepting it, that you had a continuity of the same populations in India throughout history. There's no evidence of steppe people, either before 1500 BC or even after it. Their indications are very small. And the oldest population is actually from Gujarat. You seem to be a little bit more from that part of the country. And more recently, they are discovering the imprint of the Indic populations in Iran, eastern Iran, more than 4,000 years ago, along with an artifact showing that the Indian civilization moved out, is out of Indian theory. Conrad Elst has also emphasized that quite a bit. I've also emphasized that. That's been a contribution, the inspiration of also Sitaram Bose. So that is going on. We've also found the oldest chariots in the world at Sonali, not far from Delhi, going back more than 4,000 years, made of copper. Aryan chariots up there. And the geneticists have also been working on the animals and their contribution, and they found that the Brahma bull, the zebu, was the main animal used in Iran some more than 4,000 years ago, and that the Indian horse is genetically connected to the Arabian horse with 34 ribs. This is a genetic statement, and it cannot be equated with the Central Asian horse. In fact, so far, exactly where and when the Central Asian horse came is not known in terms of the genetic record. So a lot of these historical markers have also moved in terms of our favor. Of course, the whole geology and Saraswati River, that is a bit more well known. So what's been amazing about the work of Sitaram Bose and Ram Swarup is the different areas they covered at these critical edge of Hindu thought in the late 19th, I should say the late 20th century. And its legacy today is all these movements, all these inquiries, all these thoughts are going forward. But strangely, perhaps we can understand in human mind, a lot of the young people don't know about Voice of India. They have received ideas from me, from Alice, from Sadhguru Sadhya, from Michelle Benino, from Raji Malhotra, and they think that these ideas came from the people they read. They don't realize that these ideas had history. It would not have been possible without a prior work. And along with Voice of India and also with Cesar Abloh, I also was working very closely with RSS on many different levels that had supported this work on all the different subjects involved. Recently, in March, I was in Ahmedabad. I gave a talk there, and I was there with Kumar Bhagwat. And we released a book of Rama Swaroop, along with my foreword, in Hindi, on all these different issues. Sitaram Bose's work is a little more well known. It still should be much more well known than it is, but Ram Swaroop's work is not so well known. There are four volumes of his collective works that are very important. He wrote on Hinduism, he wrote on Hinduism and monotheistic traditions, he wrote on words, revelation, names of gods, and he also wrote on yoga and meditation. He set up this metaphysical foundation of the Hindu movement quite clearly. He also wrote on some of the more mundane social political issues. Sitaram Bose wrote mainly on the religious issues, but also to some extent political issues. And he was the one who really galvanized the Hindus against this missionary influence. Catholic ashrams. But again, they came to begin to establish dialogue and discover that there was no dialogue going on there at all. So it's very important that their legacy is preserved and that they are honored. When Ram Swaroop passed away, it's called the Great Rishi by RSS and leaders. And I know their work has been widely studied. RSS throughout the world has been ordering and studying these particular books. At the same time, I think there needs to be a greater study of the works. And I think Ram Swaroop's books in particular need more examination today to create that broader philosophical, metaphysical foundation. But it's essential that there is a Hindu critique of the religions of the world, and also Luke has a Hindu critique of Christianity and Islam. That is a very good place to start. There's always the famous quote of Mahatma Gandhi when asked about Western civilization, he said it would be a good idea. So the point is that there also needs to be a Hindu critique of Western civilization, and both the good and the bad. Because Western civilization does not have this science of consciousness. It regards the intellectual, who is often a Rajasic character, as the ultimate spokesperson, who may be a genius, or maybe someone who has some scientific insight, or today a technocrat. But without having that deeper Rishi vision, how can humanity be guided? We could say that Swaroop has brought that Rishi vision back. There is benefits to Western science and technology, but there are also problems involved, and new critique is necessary relative to the information technology. We don't have time to address that. It's another topic, but essentially the mechanical way of life, the control by drugs and media is going in a big way in the Western world. It's coming also. And the cultural war against Hinduism continues. Ram Swaroop and Sitaram Bose will address that clearly. From their time and their place, we have more work going on, but it's still continuing and creating new avenues and inroads from various media and commercial levels. So we might say that Ram Swaroop and Sitaram Bose were pioneers of this Hindu awakening, and it's coming to the fore today. We also see we have won significant victories like Ayodhya and even Kashmir, education system needs a more fundamental overhaul. Academia and media have made some changes, but more needs to be done on those in those areas. Hindus need to be political. Hindus are the least political of any religions or social movement in the world. Politics is the we might say the currency. If you don't vote, you don't get anything. You're not rewarded for not. So it's very important that we honor these things and we go back to their work And we encourage the young people to study their work and the writers today to credit them for the insights that come along. They were also not the first. There was Aurobindo, there was Anirban, there was Savarta Ramdas. People forget that the guru of Shivaji was a great Advaita Vedanta who also set up all these Hanuman wrestling and gyms throughout Maharashtra to make people strong. That Kshatriya Dharma needs to come back. Sitaram, when I was in England and London and throughout England in 1996, I've done some tour. I was talking to Sitaram from a distance, and he said, "What are you talking about?" I've actually said, "The natural Kshatriya." And he said, "We have to emphasize that. The intellectual has to also be a Kshatriya, and that the first level of defense for a country is the intellectual." And India has been deprived of that by its Nehruvian academia media. So, as I said, Sitaram Bose is the foremost intellectual Kshatriya of modern India. He spoke very boldly. In fact, some people probably think it's a little bit offensive what he said. I once asked him why he speaks so boldly. He says, "Today, if I don't, they will not listen, and I will not be heard." Ramsun took more of the role of the rishi, the seer, the guide, the one who was quiet. But he also saw and made sure of the influences that they influenced many people, including my friend Lokesh Chandra. One of the four volumes of Ramsun's collected works was put together and edited by Lokesh Chandra. Their influence has gone very far, in spite of the lack of our support or resources to promote it. So I'm very happy that we are at least addressing that to some extent today. And I know RSS has created some movements through Ramsarup for at least the movement in India. But we need more of that, and we need to produce more thinkers like this, and also honor that heritage, because it had not come along with that intellectual defense. Swami Chinmayanandu was doing it, and Swami Dayananda did it, but most of the gurus didn't do it. It was caught up in the Sarvadharma. Some Baba, the intellectuals, were compromised by Marxism and by wanting to gain favor of the monopolistic dynasty. So if they hadn't served that crucial role of the intellectual defense of Hinduism, this whole modern Hindu way may not have occurred. Or it may occur much more slowly. So we have to honor these pioneers, continue their legacy, which means we do have to ask critical questions. We have to be willing to challenge distortions. And we cannot just pretend that everything is going to be okay because karma is with us, or, you know, gurus are with us, or Shiva is with us. We ourselves must act. And today, the decisive turn, I would say, has been made with the Modi government. But we need to push it further. There's a generational change that's required, an institutional change that is required, a change in the mindset. When there is still tremendous resistance from overseas forces, because all the other countries in the region would prefer a weaker Indian or a weaker Hinduism, naturally, why people. To have the, was the second largest country in the world in population strong. So that we must remember, and we must not give up our vigilance. We must remain kind and considerate, but we must hold to the truth, even if it is unpleasant, whether for ourselves or even unpleasant for others. And we must promote the culture. The culture is what is surviving all the festivals, all the rituals, all the temples, supporting is very important. We won't go into the details of that now. We also need to teach the Vedantic philosophy to everyone. Advaita, that's not the issue, but it's the foundations that are necessary to understand the counter negative theologies. We need to criticize this whole conversion-based movement. You're certainly free to follow whatever religion you want, but when you're seeking to convert us, challenge you and expose your motivation and your spiritual way that you can approach life. The tourism mission is today, they're coming on tourist visas. That also needs to be exposed. So in other words, even though a decisive turn has been made, much more work needs to be done. Never underestimate your enemy, and also recognize the outside forces that are supporting these groups in the country. But I think the long run, we say Satya may be jayate, that is in the world of eternity. It's also in the long term in history. We have to be here for the long run. And now that we have the proper intellectual and spiritual foundation, we have to share and let people know, all you children should know the basic principles that Ram Swarup shared about critique of Christianity and Islam. So when someone asks them, you know, what do you believe in, you can also reply and he was always asking, what is your one book? He said, we are not people who live in the library. We would never reply to one book. Only we need to address these particular issues. So with these comments, I will bring my lecture talk to a close. But in summary, this legacy should be preserved and shared, and maybe reorganized within certain concepts and forms, and also correlated other teachings and critiques. Follow the example of Shankaracharya, for example. We travel all over India, but also a critique of all the systems of thought, and make sure that we have the intellectual acumen to deal with the media. Now, on one level, Sitaram and Ramsu would mainly emphasize the English medium, because that was the intelligence that they had to address. That was the medium they had to address. It's important that goes on, but it's also important that these ideas are brought into local languages as well. So I thank the India Policy Foundation for organizing this event and Chandra Mr. Motivation behind it, we have to be suggested.
Professor Kapil Kapoor is currently chairman of the Indian Institute of Advanced Study. He is one of the, you can say, renowned, one of the best, I would say, linguists in the world. He has been professor of English literature, he has been professor of Sanskrit, and he has been professor of linguistics. He has written the Encyclopedia of Hinduism, 11-volume encyclopedia. He has worked on various, you could say, thought processes, written, you could say, Indian knowledge traditions, extensively written on language. Also, you could say, he was the chairman of the Committee for Language Policy.
Namaskar, sir. I must first pay my respect to Dr. David Ramiji for his very learned discourse today. Starting from this 20th century, 1950 to 1990, work of these two giants, he took us through, in fact, the journey even of the Western tradition. Western tradition, civilizational problems, and the thoughts expressed in relation to the Hindu civilization, and the threats or challenges that the Hindu civilization has faced, and how at a particular point of time in so-called independent India, you see, or partition India, or divided India, it was a very different kind of challenge to talk of things at a time when apparently you had your own government. So you seem to be arguing against your own government. Earlier, we were arguing against the British, we were arguing against the Mughals. But after 47, we were apparently arguing apparently about against our own people, who in fact were not really our own people. They were a continuation of the previous, they were an incarnation of the previous, and they are there, their own men. Being lit, and then sir has also drawn our attention to the incomplete task, that is the issues and problems that the Hindu society faced, and that Ram Sarupji and Sitaram Goyalji handled and countered, and those still need to be countered. They are still there. Thank you very much, sir, for a very educative and a very learned discourse. Thank you once again. I today want to start with a very interesting coincidence. You know, I had read about a day or 2 days back that the first FIR in Ram Janmabhoomi case was filed in 1858, and it was filed against Nihang Sikhs. So the Ram Janmabhoomi movement was also started by the Sikhs. We should remember that. And today, we have among us the last testimony given in the court case, last testimony on behalf of Hindu Mahasabha by Sardar Ravi Ranjit Singh Ji, who is sitting there. His testimony has gone on record. So you see, we have a living evidence here today of a community which has for the last 500 years defended the Hindu civilization. The six. You see? Defended the Hindu civilization. So this is one. And from there, I was reminded of another thing. You know, when the Madhya Pradesh government, jab Madhya Pradesh Sarkar, Sanchi mein, university banana chahi, 2008 mein bani, 5-6 में मेंटर ग्रुप बना, तो हमने उनको सजेस्ट किया कि सांची में उस बोधि ट्री की ब्रांच, जो बोधि वृक्ष अनुराधापुर श्रीलंका में है, जो कि बोध गया के बोधि ट्री के सैपलिंग से ही बना लगा था, जो 2040 बीसी में अशोक की बेटी संघमित्रा वो सैपलिंग लेके श्रीलंका गई थी, श्रीलंका वो लगाया था, और उन पेड़ों को लोगों ने मरने नहीं दिया, उसकी सैपलिंग से प्लांट की ब्रांच से वही पेड़ चलता रहा। तो 2008 में वो सैपलिंग लाके मोती का सांची में लगाया। अगर आप कभी भोपाल से सागर जाए बाई रोड, तो आपको थोड़े कोई 125-150 किलोमीटर के बाद राइट साइड पे पहाड़ी के ऊपर एक बड़ा ब्यूटीफुल पेड़ अकेला दिखेगा, वो बोधि वृक्ष है। अब गया का बोधि वृक्ष 600 बीसी का, अनुराधापुर में लगा 240 बीसी में, उसी वृक्ष की ब्रांच 2008 में लगी सांची में। ये है हमारी भारतीय सभ्यता की कंटिन्यूटी। जितना भी ऑनस्लॉट हुआ, हर प्रकार जितने भी जुर्म हुए, जितने भी लाखों लोगों ने शहादत दी, पर ये देश, ये संस्कृति अविचल अवच्छिन्न रूप से चलती है। ये दो चंद्र है। मैं सोच रहा था कि थोड़ी ज्यादा टाइम अब मैं नहीं लूंगा क्योंकि उन्हें क्षेत्र बन ही गए हैं आपके, कि हम पहली बार जो मैं आपसे करना चाहता हूं कि शंकर शरण ने रक्षा शब्द का प्रयोग किया कि श्री राम से। अच्छा, हाँ, सीताराम गोयल जी के ग्रैंडसन भी प्रेजेंट है। वेरी ही
उनके
हमारी संस्कृति में है, हम अपने बुजुर्गों को जिन्होंने समर्पण किया है, अपना समर्पण किया है देश के लिए, उनको हम याद रखते हैं, उनको याद रखते हैं, हम याद रखते हैं। तो इनके हम उनको याद करते हैं और उनको धन्यवाद देते हैं। शंकर शरण जी ने रक्षा शब्द का प्रयोग किया था। ये सारा जो मैंने कहा कि कंटिन्यूटी अविच्छिन्न चलती रही, ये हमारे देश में एक बड़ी प्राचीन पुराने समय से धर्म रक्षा परंपरा है। और धर्म का मतलब रिलीजन नहीं है, आप तो समझते हैं। ये तो बहुत कॉमन बात हो गई है कि जब हम धर्म की बात करते हैं तो भारत की जो संस्कृति है वो धर्म की संस्कृति है। चोर का भी धर्म है, राजा का भी धर्म है, व्यक्ति का भी धर्म है, समाज का भी धर्म है, पानी का धर्म है, आग का धर्म है, उससे धर्म की संस्कृति है। तो धर्म की संस्कृति की धर्म की रक्षा इस देश में हमेशा दो प्रकार से होती है, शस्त्र और शास्त्र से। अथर्ववेद में भूमि सूक्त में ये कहा है, पॉइंट कहता है कि धरती माता उन शत्रुओं का नाश कर दो जो मेरे राष्ट्र को शस्त्र या शास्त्र से दमन करना चाहते। शत्रु जो मेरे राष्ट्र का दमन शस्त्र या शास्त्र से करना चाहते हैं उनका नाश कर। 19वीं शताब्दी तक आते आते सब के बावजूद हम शस्त्र और शास्त्र दोनों से दबे। पर एक बात हमें भूलना नहीं चाहिए, हम कहते हैं कि हजार साल देखिए बेसिकली हिंदू धर्म की या हिंदुओं की क्या प्रॉब्लम रही, हिंदुओं की सर्वाइवल प्रॉब्लम इस वक्त भी हमारी सर्वाइवल प्रॉब्लम है कि इस देश में, क्योंकि इतने साल 70 साल तो ये कोई मान ले ये भुलाया गया, और बल्कि सिर्फ भुलाया नहीं गया, लोगों को डराया गया कि अपने आप को हिंदू नहीं कह सकते, भुलाया गया कि ये हिंदू देश है। अभी सऊदी अरेबिया के प्रिंस सलमान को जब इंटरव्यू में पूछा गया कि 370 अबॉलिश करके कश्मीर उन्होंने अपने देश में जोड़ लिया है, तो सऊदी अरेबिया के सलमान ने कहा अरे वो तो हिंदू लैंड है, ये तो हिंदू लैंड है, वो बाहर वालों को पता है कि हिंदू लैंड है, और वो हिंदुस्तान कहते हैं हिंदुस्तान। इस शब्द को कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन से जानबूझ के निकाला गया, हिंदुस्तान इंडिया दैट इज भारत, पर हिंदुस्तान नहीं, हिंदू लैंड है। पर हिंदू क्योंकि हिंदू ये नरसिम्हा राव जी ने भी कहा इंडिया इज नो लॉन्गर ए हिंदू कंट्री, यू नो उन्होंने ये कहा इज नो लॉन्गर ए हिंदू कंट्री, मिक्स हो गया है। अब इस सेंस में तो अमेरिका ब्रिटेन एवरी कंट्री यू नो मिक्स्ड पॉपुलेशन, तो उससे क्या Does Britain cease to be a Christian country? Does America cease to be a Christian country? तो ये survival की जो problem तो अभी भी हमारी चल रही है, जैसे कि पवन जी ने कहा, और उसमें कुछ issues हैं जिनके कारण हमें प्रतिकार करना है, जिनका हमें प्रतिकार करना है तभी होगा। तो सबसे पहली बात कि तीन तीन फेज हम तीन पीरियड है हमारे को जो तीन पीरियड ओवर 2000 साल में तीन पीरियड है जिसमें हमें प्रतिकार करना पड़ा अपने लिए रक्षा करनी पड़ी। पहला पीरियड शुरू और ये सारा सारे सारी इस प्रॉब्लम का स्रोत एक ही है, स्रोत है राइज ऑफ अब्राहमिक रिलीजन्स। जब वो जूडाइज्म क्रिश्चियनिटी और इस्लाम का उदय हुआ, जूडाइज्म की प्रॉब्लम नहीं है क्योंकि जूडाइज्म प्रोसेलिटाइज नहीं करते, वो प्रोसेलिटाइज इसलिए नहीं करते कि उन्होंने लोगों के और भगवान के बीच में किसी व्यक्ति को नहीं डाला। क्रिश्चियनिटी ने डाला जीसस, इस्लाम ने डाला मोहम्मद, क्योंकि भगवान तो नहीं कह सकता ना कि इसको इसको तुम मारो या इसको बदलो, और इंसान कह सकता है। तो दो प्रोसेलिटाइजिंग रिलीजन्स के राइज के कारण हमारी प्रॉब्लम शुरू हुई जब उनका इन्वेजन इस्लामिक इन्वेजन शुरू हुए। भारत का अरब देशों के साथ संबंध बहुत पुराना है, इस्लाम से पहले आपको रिकॉर्ड मिलते हैं अरब स्कॉलर्स के जो कहते हैं कि कौन हिंदू हिंदुओं का मुकाबला कर सकता है उनके ज्ञान में, उनकी एस्ट्रोनॉमी में, उनके मैथमेटिक्स में। आप तो जानते ही है ये जो अरब वर्ल्ड अरब 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 अरबी भाषा में जो न्यूमरल्स है उसका शब्द क्या है, हिंसे 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 हिंद से हिंद से, और जो उनकी तलवार है उसका भी था हिंसी हिंसी, मतलब हिंद के स्टील से बनी हुई, क्योंकि भारत में स्टील 2000-2500 साल से बनाया जाता है भट्टियों में, लोहारों की भट्टियों में। अभी भी बेलारी में कर्नाटक में आपको लोहार की भट्टी में बूट्स स्टील बनता है बनाते हैं। तो जो जिस सोर्ड से सोर्ड ऑफ इस्लाम जिससे उन्होंने पूरा तुम्हें पते किया, वो सोर्ड का स्टील भी हिंद हिंद का था, हिंसी कहते हैं। तो इनका बड़ा हमारा संबंध रहा। जब ये जो अब्राहम है एक ईश्वर वाली एक किताब वाले एक सच वाले, एक ही ईश्वर है, एक ही किताब है और एक ही सच है, एक ही सच है, दूसरा नहीं। और दूसरी और दूसरे लेवल पे भेद 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 जब हमारा आपका हमारे से भेद है तो हम उस भेद को मिटा देंगे। ये भेद उसके रिलेशन हुए, यू नो कहना नहीं चाहिए कई बार, क्योंकि हम लोग खासकर बोलने में कतराते हैं कि भाई अच्छा नहीं लगता कि ठीक है वो बातें बीत गई, जो बीत गई सो बीत गई, अब क्यों। पर विल ड्यूरेंट की जो हिस्ट्री ऑफ सिविलाइजेशन है उसका जो दसवां चैप्टर है, उसका दसवां चैप्टर है इस्लामिक इन्वेजन ऑफ इंडिया। उसका पहला सेंटेंस है इस्लामिक इन्वेजन ऑफ इंडिया इज द क्रूएलेस्ट इज द मोस्ट वायलेंट पीरियड ऑफ ह्यूमन हिस्ट्री, मोस्ट वायलेंट ऑफ ह्यूमन हिस्ट्री। बहुत कम लोग जानते हैं कि हिंदू कुश पर्वत, मतलब का नाम था हिंदुओं को मारने वाला कुश, कुशावर्त घाट, समझते हो ना, हिंदू कुश माउंटेन। यहाँ पे जिस जब शायद जब वो किसी स्टेट को किंगडम को कैप्चर करते थे, इसका कोई रिलेशनशिप हमारे आजकल के मुस्लिम भाइयों से नहीं। हम उनके उन बातों को लेके इनको हम कुछ नहीं कह सकते, ना कहना चाहिए, पर जो इतिहास में हुआ उसको भूलना भी ठीक नहीं है। यू शुड नॉट फॉरगेट, यू मे फॉरगेट बट यू शुड नॉट फॉरगेट। यू सी द ज्यूज, उन्होंने सॉलोमन का टेम्पल का टूटना वो आज तक नहीं भूले। अभी तक उस दिन जिस दिन वो टूटा था, इट इज देयर डे ऑफ मोर्निंग, डे ऑफ मोर्निंग। तो एक प्रिजनर्स को ले जाते थे, अब गर्म क्लाइमेट है ऐसी कपड़ों में ले गए, ठंडे ठंडे पहाड़ों की आई कि आधे 25% तो मर जाते। आज भी आपको उज़्बेकिस्तान में ताजिकिस्तान में आपको रिकॉर्ड मिलते हैं कि हिंदुस्तान का मेल इस उम्र का कितने में बिकता था, फीमेल कितने में जीतती थी उसी और है बहुत जल्द बहुत हुआ बिटवीन 1200 एंड 1500 इंडिया पॉपुलेशन 10/8 करोड़ 10/8 यू सी दीज आर थिंग्स विच आर ट्रिमेंडस even then we survived because as Karl Marx says in his notes on Indian history, he says that the Martians, Iranian, they succumbed to the Arab armies in 30 years and were converted. Pure Persians 30 saal mein haar gaye aur convert ho gaye. How is it that the Hindus put up a deadly resistance and it took Islamic armies 400 years to move from Herat or Kabul to Delhi? 400 years. 1,000 or 1,200 kilometers, say 800-900 miles in about 400 years. Because at every step, deadly resistance of the Hindus. And he said it was possible because हमारे हिंदू समाज में जो जो मॉडल क्लास थी पंडित परंपरा जो थी जो ब्राह्मण था वो रोल मॉडल था वो आइडियल था वो टीचर था और वो त्यागी था रेनंसिएट था और पूरा गांव उसकी बात और इट इज दी पंडित्स और ब्राह्मण्स हु ऑर्गेनाइज द रेजिस्टेंस जबकि ईरान की जो रिलीजियस क्लास थी वो बड़ी डीजनरेट थी दे वर नॉट रोल मॉडल्स दे वर नॉट इंटेलेक्चुअल इसलिए उनके कोई जोड़ने वाला नहीं था तो स्टम्प कर गए तो इसी के कारण जब इस्लामिक आर्मीज किसी बड़े शहर में जाती थी उसका जो मेन मंदिर तोड़ती थी मंदिर के चारों तरफ ब्राह्मण रहते थे उनका जनरल स्लॉटर करते दे वर सीन एज मेन एनिमीज जनरल स्लॉटर और ब्रिटिश ने भी 18th सेंचुरी में आने के बाद उन्होंने एंटी ब्राह्मणिज्म को स्टेट पॉलिसी बनाई स्टेट पॉलिसी क्योंकि दे न्यू बिकॉज हम सारे बनवाले की रिपोर्ट करते हैं पर वुड्स का डिस्पैच जो था वुड्स ने भी एक इंग्लिश एजुकेशन एक्ट लगाया इंग्लिश एजुकेशन एक्ट उसके बाद 1881 में इंडिया की लिटरेसी फेल टू 16% आप जरा सोचिए क्यों आई टेल यू वेरी सिंपल लिटरेसी इनफैक्ट मेरे सेड इन द हाउस ऑफ कॉमन्स दैट इन सम पार्ट्स ऑफ इंडिया लिटरेसी इज 100% एवरेज इज 97% बिकॉज द एजुकेशन वाज गिवन इन द लैंग्वेजेस ऑफ द स्टेट्स उनकी स्टेट जो प्रांतीय भाषाएं थी उनमें एवरीवन देयर वर 257,000 स्कूल्स इन 1830 स्कूल्स गुरुकुल पाठशाला और वो जो जो आसमान भाइयों का मदरसे पाठशाला ये 257,000 है और वो बुक्स ने कहा कि एक हर गांव में एक है कोई नॉर्मी पढ़ाता है अमाउंट पढ़ाता है कोई बंदियों पढ़ाता है कोई पढ़ाता सारे बच्चे लड़के लड़कियां हिंदू मुस्लिम सब लोग स्कूल में जाके पढ़ते इकट्ठे और सिर्फ 12% टीचर ब्राह्मण है सिर्फ 12% तो ये सारी जो गलत फहमियां फैलाई गई है ये ब्राह्मणों के हाथ में था ब्राह्मणों की वो एंटी ब्राह्मणिज्म स्टेट पॉलिसी उसकी भंडारकर का ऐसे है 1884 का एंटी ब्राह्मणिज्म स्टेट पॉलिसी और आज भी वही चल रही है चलती रही अब खत्म होगी शायद क्योंकि ब्राह्मण्स हैव बीन मेड द ज्यूज ऑफ इंडिया ब्राह्मण्स आर द ज्यूज ऑफ इंडिया जैसे यूरोप में एवरीथिंग रॉन्ग वाज एट्रिब्यूटेड टू द ज्यूज सब उसी तरह यहाँ अगर वर्षा ज्यादा फ्लड आ गया तो ब्राह्मणों के कारण सूखा पड़ गया तो ब्राह्मणों के कारण अमेरिका ने एटम बम चला दिया तो हमारे बराबर हो गया
एवरीथिंग
सब चीजों पे ब्लेम करो इट वाज अ कॉन्स्पिरेसी टू सबवर्ट टू ब्रेक डाउन आवर इंटेलेक्चुअल स्ट्रेंथ आवर ग्रेट नॉलेज ट्रेडिशंस हु प्रिजर्व्ड आवर नॉलेज ट्रेडिशंस हमारे ग्रंथों को किसने बचाया 2000 साल जब दोनों मंजिलों की लाइब्रेरियां जला दी गई पर ग्रंथ आपके पास पहुंच गए क्योंकि एक एक पंडित फैमिली एक ग्रंथ को संभाल लेती थी और बाय मेमोरी अपने चिल्ड्रन को डिसेंडेंट को अगर लड़का लायक है जो कम होते थे तो भतीजे को वो लायक होता था उसको सिखा देते थे पटोजी दीक्षित मोटा भक्त तो जनरेशन है दरिद्रता में रहते हैं दरिद्रता में सीताराम गोयल जी को भी दरिद्रता देखनी पड़ी अगर वो बुद्धि जी भी होते आजकल की तरह मतलब बुद्धि बेच के जीविका कमाने वाले थोड़ी मेहनत की सहयोग कर देते तो कोची भी मिल जाती चेयरमैन सीट भी मिल जाती इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ऑर्गेनिक शिमला वैसे मुझे ऐसे नहीं मिली मतलब वो बुद्धिजीवी नहीं थे ना देखिए हमारे तीन शब्द बड़े बड़े ब्यूटीफुल है व्यक्ति के धर्म के अर्पण समर्पण और तर्पण ये दम नमन ये जो मैं कर रहा हूं अपने लिए ही कर रहा है अर्पण कर दिया किसी चीज को और सब कुछ समर्पित कर दिया उसको धन भी जो भी मिलता है तो फिर उसका तर्पण कर दिया ये जो मैं कर रहा हूं ये अपने लिए नहीं तो इस तरह के व्यक्ति थे इस तरह के पंडित थे जिन्होंने पूरी हमारी सिविलाइजेशन को बचाया तो इस्लाम पीरियड में भी सर दोनों प्रकार से शस्त्र और शास्त्र दोनों से रक्षा हुई शस्त्र से ज्यादा जरूरत और शस्त्र से हुई में जो हिस्ट्री पढ़ाई जाती है उसमें हमें लगता है कि हिंदू लोग पिटते हैं ऐसा नहीं है ऐसा नहीं है आप तो अगर एक एक बिल्कुल नामावली जैसे हमारे यहाँ सहस्त्र नाम होते हैं ना नामावली के लिए शाहून शाही काबुल के हाँ? और अपारा डायनेस्टी पेशावर की पारा डायनेस्टी पेशावर की फिर दित्य डायनेस्टी यही फिर शाह डायनेस्टी श्रीनगर की शाह डायनेस्टी फिर खोखर जेलम डिस्ट्रिक्ट के जसवंत खोखर 1380 में फांसी पर चढ़ाया गया लाहौर में खोखर फिर राजपूत राणा कुंभा 12वीं शताब्दी से 12वीं से 16वीं शताब्दी राजपूत और फिर काकतिया डायनेस्टी वारंगल में फ्रॉम दी 13th सेंचुरी 13th and 14th सेंचुरी काकतिया डायनेस्टी में तो हरियर और बुक्का जो उसके जनरल थे उन्होंने विजयनगर में शुरू किया 1562 तक विजयनगर का दरबार रहता रहा 1562 में गिरा भाई 1600 की मराठा द्वारा अपने नाम 1627-20 में मराठा किंगडम वापस ले लिया इसके मराठा चले पूरे आपके 1700-1800 नाना फडणवीस आज के फडणवीस नहीं इनके नाना फडणवीस की डेथ हुई नाना फडणवीस की 1800 में तो ग्रांट अपने कहा विद हिम डिपार्टेड द विजडम ऑफ द मराठा आपस में फैलाओ एंड एक एक करके किंगडम डिवाइड किए और 1800 में आ गए और उधर 1500 में गुरु नानक देव गुरु नानक देव ने तो शास्त्र से बात की पर उनके शास्त्र के काम को अल्टीमेटली गुरु गोविंद सिंह जी मिले 1700 में मतलब शस्त्र और शास्त्र गुरु हरगोविंद का मीनिंग पीरी मतलब वी आर रीच 1700 एंड यू नो बाय दैट टाइम द ब्रिटिश एम्पायर है सारा ब्रोकर हो द मुस्लिम एम्पायर ब्रोकर हो देन द ब्रिटिश की ब्रिटिश पीरियड ब्रिटिश पीरियड में क्या हुआ ब्रिटिश पीरियड में देयर इज ब्रिटिश वर वेरी क्लेवर जितना डैमेज इस्लाम के समय हमें शास्त्र का चैलेंज इतना नहीं मिला शास्त्र का चैलेंज नहीं मिला पर ब्रिटिश पीरियड में हमें शास्त्र का चैलेंज शास्त्र और हमारे ही जो इंटेलिजेंट शिया है वो उनके स्कूलों में पढ़ के वो अपने ही दुश्मन हो गए और वो जो लिबरलिज्म वो जो लाए लिबरलिज्म ने इंग्लैंड की तो बड़ी भलाई की पर लिबरलिज्म ने हमारे हमारे धर्म को रविश करने के लिए मूर्ति पूजा करते हैं अंधविश्वासी है लड़कियों के साथ बड़ा अन्याय होता है विधवा का सब जानते बातें कुछ बातें ठीक भी थी उसके कारण उससे कुछ फायदा भी हुआ पर स्विंग साइड में इसका रिस्पॉन्स जो हुआ राजा राममोहन रॉय ऑलमोस्ट क्रिश्चियन हो गए, कई लोग क्रिश्चियन हो गए, राजा राम को एक गलत, पर स्वामी दयानंद सरस्वती 1870-80 में स्वामी दयानंद सरस्वती ने इसका जवाब दिया है, जो स्वामी जी कह रहे थे कि थ्री टीचिंग दी वेस्टर्न सिविलाइजेशन, उन्होंने क्रिटिक किया, उन्होंने क्रिटिक किया, उन्होंने उसको ही कैरीड दी बैटल टू दैट टू देम, उन्होंने सत्याग्रह प्रकाश में उनके ग्रंथों को लेके क्रिटिसिज्म किया, क्रिटिसिज्म किया। तो स्वामी दयानंद की वो स्वामी श्रद्धानंद थी, स्वामी श्रद्धानंद जी ने 1901 में गुरुकुल कांगड़ी यूनिवर्सिटी बनाई, 3-4 अंग्रेजी यूनिवर्सिटियां बन चुकी थी, मद्रास, कलकत्ता और बॉम्बे, उसके बाद लाहौर की यूनिवर्सिटी, 5वीं यूनिवर्सिटी श्रद्धानंद जी ने बनाई, एंड देन श्रद्धानंद जी वाज असैसिनेटेड, देयर इज नो एंड, देयर इज नो एंड टू दिस काइंड ऑफ रेजिस्टेंस दैट हैज बीन पुट अप इन द ब्रिटिश पीरियड। द ब्रिटिश पीरियड एज आई सेड वाज अ शस्त्र, एक किस्म का डिसेप्टिव, लोग खुद एजुकेशन ले रहे हैं, हम खुद ही कह रहे हैं कौन सी एजुकेशन जो कि हमारी ही कल्चर को अंडरकट कर, हमारी ही कल्चर अंडरकट करती, इसलिए उस वक्त देयर आर वेरी फ्यू वॉइसेस, बहुत कम वॉइसेस हु विल स्पीक अगेंस्ट, अगेन जो जो अंग्रेजों के जमाने में हिंदुओं को हिंदू संस्कृति सभ्यता का क्या नुकसान हो रहा है उसके लिए यू हैड टू सी थ्रू, इट वॉज नॉट अपेरेंट, यू हैड टू सी थ्रू कि स्लोली जैसे स्लो पॉइजन से लोग के बदला जाता है, इस प्रकार हिंदू माइंड को सबवर्ट किया जा रहा है और कॉलोनाइज किया जा रहा है, और हो गया, हो गया, और उसका उस जमाने में, उस जमाने में मतलब इनका बहुत कम लोगों में से रामस्वरूप जी और वो सीताराम मोहन जैसे दो विद्वान जिन्होंने इन सब खतरों को देखा, इन खतरों को देखा और शस्त्र से तो अपोजिशन हुआ, शस्त्र से भी अपोजिशन हुआ ब्रिटिश पीरियड में, मतलब आपके जो भगत सिंह से भगत सिंह और वो जो क्षति खुदीराम बोस, हजारों यंग मैन हु टू टू वायलेंस अपोज करने के लिए, एंड द अदर साइड पर शास्त्र से, क्योंकि शास्त्र को हमने खूब एक्सेप्ट कर लिया, हमने अपने शास्त्र छोड़ दिया जो मूल पीरियड में नहीं हुआ, हमने शास्त्र तो छोड़ दिए, अपना अपने आप एक्सेप्ट कर लिया, तो हमने हमने से जो पढ़ के निकले वो तो किसी उनको तो कोई नजर ही नहीं आया कि कुछ किसी चीज का हमें विरोध करना है। तो अनंत कुमार स्वामी जब कहते हैं एजुकेटेड इंडियंस, तो वो कहते हैं दिस इज हाउ विक्टिम्स ऑफ इंडियन एजुकेशन आर डिस्क्राइब, क्योंकि जो एजुकेटेड इंडियन, मैक्स म्यूलर कहता है, मैं बड़ा हैरान होता हूँ कि जब मैं किसी पढ़े लिखे हिंदुस्तानी के सामने वेदों की और वेदों की या कोई उसकी बड़े ग्रेट की बात करता हूँ तो वो थोड़े चुपचाप होकर थोड़ी देर में इधर उधर के समझाते हैं, उनको शर्म आती है, दे डोंट वांट टू लिसन टू दीस थिंग्स। तो ये जो जिसको मैं आज 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 भी हालत ऐसी है, आज तो बदल गई काफी, पर जब हमने बोलना शुरू किया था 75 में तो यूनिवर्सिटियों में लेक्चरों में हमारे लेक्चर में से लोग माफ़ कर जाते, कह रहे थे ये पुरानी बातें हैं, ये तो संस्कृतिकेशन है, ये तो सुपरस्टिशियस है, ये बैकवर्ड नॉलेज है, न्यू नॉलेज है सुपरसीडेड, हमारा माइंड इतना इन्वेस्ट कर, इसलिए ब्रिटिश वर मोर डेंजरस फॉर दी, उनका उनका जो उनके समय में ज्यादा खतरा, क्यों वो खतरा ऑब्वियस नहीं है, ऊपर नहीं है, वो हमें देख के समझना पड़ता है कि ये खतरा है, ये खतरा है। और उसी में उस वक्त ये दो विद्वान थे जो बुद्धिजीवी नहीं थे, बाकी सारे बुद्धिजीवी थे, कमिश्नर्स वाले थे, इतने बड़े बड़े नाम है, अंग्रेजी पढ़े लिखे, हम काउंट करते हैं, गिनाए जाते हैं ब्रिटिश पीरियड में, आप अगर ब्रिटिश हिस्ट्री पढ़ो किताबों की, एनसीईआरटी की, कि कितने ग्रेट डिबेट करने वाले इंडियंस थे, श्रीनिवास राव खुराना, वी श्रीनिवास भागवत वाले, जो कि अंग्रेजी में बड़ी एक्सलेंस है, अंग्रेजी में बड़े एक्सलेंस, ये जवाहरलाल नेहरू बड़ी बड़ी अंग्रेजी बोलते थे, लिखते थे, उनकी किताब में जब यही क्राइटेरियन बन गया अपना, एक बार मेरी बिज्जा को बना था ना भारत ये जो खोज डिस्कवरी ऑफ इंडिया थे, तो मेरी बेटी 6 साल की थी, मुझे कहा पापा नेहरू इंडियन नहीं था, मैं इंडियन था, तो फिर वो खोज क्या रहा। आप
forgot yourself, not up and look in, तो उस वक्त एनालिसिस करना और कोई भी इशू जो आजकल भी हमारे सामने है ऐसा कोई भी इशू नहीं है जो बोले सीताराम गोयल जी ने या राम स्वरूप जी ने जिसका रिजॉइंडर नहीं दिया आपने तो मैं उसे नहीं सुनाता हूँ जैसे कम्युनिस्ट माओइस्ट ऐसा वगैरह सेक्युलरिज्म मीडिया बायस हिस्ट्री री रिटन इंडिया एजुकेशन India's economics and the governance, the loaded governance against Hindus, loaded governance. मैं example ये करता था कि अभी थोड़ी सब चीजें बदल रही हैं कुछ साल पहले तक even the judiciary, जो Hindu festivals हैं वो सारे polluting हैं, वो polluting festival रंग भी pollute करता है, पटाखे से आवाज बड़ी होती है धुआं बड़ा निकलता है धुएं से शहर वाले बड़े हो जाते हैं ना पराली जला रहे हैं पराली तुम्हें अच्छी लगती तो चावल खाना बंद कर दो कड़क खानी बंद कर दो पराली नहीं जलेगी पराली के धुएं से रूरल इंडिया डिसइंफेक्ट हो जाता है डेंगू गांव में नहीं होता यू सी ये पराली पराली करते रहते जो आपके 45 लाख गाड़ी यहाँ चलती है ना उसका धुआं नहीं दिखता परंतु उसका पेट्रोल या डीजल जाता है ना उसके जो नॉक्सियस फ्यूम्स है बीमारियां उससे होती है धुएं से नहीं होती धुएं में तो हम पले हम तो किचन में लकड़ी के चूल्हा जला के बाहर रोटी बनाती थी आंखों से पानी आता खाकर तो ये जो मॉडर्निज्म है ना मॉडर्निटी जिसको कहा जाता है मॉडर्न को एक सुपीरियर कल्चर मानते हैं मॉडर्न इज नॉट ए सुपीरियर कल्चर इट इज एन अल्टरनेटिव कल्चर It is an alternative. And we are not a pre-modern society. We were not a pre-modern society. We are a non-modern society. Non-modern, not pre-modern. So, jitne issues dikhiye, governance and cultural alienation of Hindus from themselves. IIT mein ek baar lecture maine kaha ki I am not very happy, but it is important. That I am talking to disaffiliated Indians. We are all disaffiliated people. अपने आप से disaffiliated हुए हुए हम मजाक में कहा करते थे जी कि पांच पांडवों के नाम नहीं आते हैं और आप उनसे पूछते हो यदि आप अद्वैत के पांच थिंकर्स के नाम बताओ शंकराचार्य रामानुजाचार्य मध्वाचार्य निम्बार्काचार्य वल्लभाचार्य आगे ना पूछना उन्होंने किया क्या आपका नाम ना पूछना पांच पांडवों की जो कहते हो मैं सुनाता था वो सब पहले किसी को पूछा पांच पांडवों के नाम आते हैं यही आते हैं बताओ तो ये एक तो भीम एक उसका बड़ा भाई एक छोटा भाई और वो के नाम भूल गया वो के नाम भूल गया आप उनसे पूछो कि रावण के चेहरे भी ये जो जो स्कूल था जो उन्होंने रिफ्लेक्ट किया शंकराचार्य की अद्वैत को उसको क्या क्या था पूछे अच्छे लोगों को नहीं पता नाम नहीं पता जगह में नहीं पता कहाँ रहते थे इतना गांव में इतना इतने इतने बड़े थिंकर हुए हैं इस कंट्री में ह्यूज चाइना के पास एक कन्फ्यूशियस है और वो 300 चेयर बता दी 300 चेयर हमारे यहाँ इतने थिंकर है पर हमारी फिलोसफी हो गई कंफ्यूजनिज्म कंफ्यूजनिज्म नहीं कंफ्यूजनिज्म हम कुछ नहीं कर पाते न पढ़ते हैं न पढ़ाते हैं न पढ़ते हैं न पढ़ाते हैं तो इस वक्त जो 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 लेसन देखिए सीताराम गोयल जी और इनका जो दर्द था वो दर्द था कि हिंदू समाज की जो दुर्दशा और हिंदू खुद गिनती है आप अभी भी देख रहे हैं ना इनको जरा सी टुकड़ा जमीन दे दो तब तक तो दोनों भाई इकट्ठे जोर लगाते रहेंगे जब मिल जाएगा तो खूब लड़ेंगे आपस में मैं वो शब्द यूज नहीं करना चाहता और लड़ता है ऐसे लड़ने लग जाते तो ये 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 जो चरित्र है ये चरित्र का हनन हुआ हम अपने आप से बाहर ना निकल के अब अर्पण समर्पण तर्पण नहीं होता अब नहीं होता
अब अपना और धर्म अर्थ काम मोक्ष नहीं है, अब अर्थ और काम है बस, बहुत कम रह गए दूसरी प्रैक्टिस नहीं रही। तो इस सारे का कारण यह है कि हमारी शिक्षा एलियन है, हमारी शिक्षा ईईई इंग्लिश एजुकेशन एम्प्लॉयमेंट, इसको हमने 70 साल में छोड़ा नहीं। मैं आप लोग सारे लर्नेड इंपॉर्टेंट लोग हो, आपका वॉइस मैटर करता है। मैंने एक फॉर्मल मीटिंग में, केएम की मीटिंग में, मैंने मिनिस्टर साहब से कहा कि सर जिस पॉलिसी के आधार पे 184 साल से हमारी शिक्षा चल रही है, वो पॉलिसी डॉक्यूमेंट एक पेज का था, एक पेज साइंड बाय लॉर्ड बेंटिंक, उसमें सिर्फ 4 पॉइंट थे। हमने ऐसे भारतीय पैदा करने हैं, वो दिखे भारतीय पर अपने टेस्ट में, ओपिनियंस में, मॉरल्स में और इंटेलेक्ट में ब्रिटिश। कैसे करें, हम इनको मातृभाषा में नहीं पढ़ाए, ये तरीका इनको वो बनाने, भारतीय को अभारतीय बनाने के लिए उसको अपनी भाषा में ना पढ़ाओ। तीसरा पढ़ाओ क्या, यूरोपियन लिटरेचर, किताबें कौन सी, वहां के ग्रंथ, वेस्टर्न संस्कृत पर्शियन के ग्रंथ ना छपने देंगे ना बांटने देंगे, ये 4 पॉइंट थी। उसके आधार पर 184 साल से हमने 1964 से लेंगे अब तक 7684 पेज लिखे हैं एजुकेशन पॉलिसी, जिसमें पॉलिसी है ही नहीं। आप क्या बातें करते हैं, यूनिवर्सिटियों को खोल देंगे, बाथरूम बड़े अच्छे बना देंगे, बिलीव भी इतना भी क्वालिटी होगी इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में, हम टीचर बढ़ा यूनिवर्सिटियां बढ़ा देंगे, कुछ को मर्ज कर देंगे, कुछ को बांट देंगे और उनकी प्रमोशन करेंगे टीचरों की, उनके स्केल बढ़ा देंगे। This is not policy. Policy तो एक है। But I said it openly. सारे ने केम मीटिंग 400 लोग बैठे थे, सारे मुख्यमंत्री बैठे थे। हमने कहा एक ही तरीका, एक एक धागा पकड़ो, जैसे गांव हमारी बुजुर्ग औरतें जब ऊन उलझ जाती थी ना तो उनको खोलना होता था, तो बड़े ध्यान से एक धागा खींचती थी और सारी ऊन उलझ जाती थी। वो एक धागा हमारी शिक्षा का है, आप शिक्षा का माध्यम प्रादेशिक भाषाएं बनाए, क्लास 1 से लेके रिसर्च तक। सारे मुख्यमंत्री बैठे थे, बारी बारी से बोले थे, एक ने भी नहीं कहा कि हम शिक्षा अपनी भाषा में देना चाहते हैं। तो किसका कसूर, मंत्री जी ने भी यही पूछा, कौन रोकता है शिक्षा, कौन रोकता है, कोई नहीं रोकता, वेस्टर्न इंटरेस्ट, बच्चे सारे इंग्लिश स्कूल में जाते हैं, मुलायम सिंह के बच्चे भी अब जाते हैं, मुझे उन्होंने खुद बताया, अरे घर घर घुस रही है अंग्रेजी बोल अब तो ये जो शिक्षा का माध्यम बदलेंगे, शिक्षा का जब तक माध्यम, आप शिक्षा का माध्यम बदल देंगे, अपनी आवाज उठानी चाहिए हम लोगों को, आप अपने अपनी भाषा, अंग्रेजी रहेगी, अंग्रेजी अब एक भारतीय भाषा है, जितनी हमारी भाषा है अंग्रेजी भी भाषा है, वो एक भारतीय भाषा ही रहेगी, उससे ज्यादा नहीं। क्या आप अपने कानून भी अंग्रेजी में बनाओ, फिर उनको भारतीय भाषाओं में ट्रांसलेट करो, आपका कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन जो कोट करना है वो भी अंग्रेजी वाला होना चाहिए, है? और जो ओरिजिनल कॉपी के ऊपर जो राम बना हुआ है, राम का राम तो हिस्टोरिकली नहीं हुआ पैदा, बाद में कहने लगे कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन पे इसकी फोटो बना दी। तो यू सी हु इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल, कौन, हम है, तो किसको किसको रोइएगा, होता है ना कि भाई अब माँ ही मारती है और माँ को ही रो के कहते हैं मत मार, वो तो बड़ा ब्यूटीफुल इमेज है। यहाँ तो हम खुद ही मुहर्रम अपना मना रहे हैं, रोज अपना हम खुद ही कर रहे हैं, मुस्लिम भाई तो एक दिन करते हैं, हम तो रोज ही करते हैं। तो ये सारे इश्यूज जो है, एजुकेशन, इकोनॉमिक, सेक्युलरिज्म, क्रिश्चियनिटी का इम्पैक्ट, कन्वर्जन, इस्लाम का, इस्लाम की क्रूरिटी, कल्चरल डेवस्टेशन ऑफ इंडिया, जहाँ सीताराम गोस्वामी ने किताब लिखी हिंदू टेम्पल्स गॉन,
सारे नॉर्थ इंडिया में आपको एक भी भव्य मंदिर नहीं मिलता, एक भी भव्य मंदिर नहीं मिलता, योगे पर आपको इफ यू ट्रेवल अक्रॉस इंडिया नॉर्थ इंडिया वन प्रोजेक्ट दैट आई वाज सजेस्टिंग समबडी वाज रुइंस ऑफ हिंदू सिविलाइजेशन. यू हैव रेड अ ह्यूज बुक ऑन रुइंस ऑफ हिंदू सिविलाइजेशन, बट वी हैव सर्वाइव्ड, वी आर स्टिल सर्वाइविंग एंड वी विल सर्वाइव बिकॉज़ वी आर बिकॉज़ एक तो रेजिलियंस बड़ी, सेकेंडली एक शाश्वत ट्रुथ है हमारे बिलीफ. हम किसी को नहीं कहते कि हम ही ठीक है तुम गलत, सबको एक्सेप्ट करते क्योंकि शाश्वत है और सनातन है और रहेंगे. पर इसमें मन जाइए कि सत्यमेव जयते, कि सच अपने आप जीतता है, कोई ना अपने आप जीतता है, किसी ने किसी को कुर्बानी देनी पड़ती है तब जीतता है, तो सेक्रीफाइस करनी पड़ती हर चीज के लिए. तो मैं थैंक करता हूँ कुलदीप रतुल जी का सबका और गौरी जी ने लीड दी है. हम क्या हम जोड़ते हैं कि आजकल क्या करना है, उन्होंने भी वही गौरी जी ने भी अंत में कहा था कि ये स्ट्रगल अभी आपको करनी है. अभी यू सेड इट सर, इजंट इट दैट वी हैव टू स्टिल यू नो वी हैव स्टिल टू फाइट दीस थिंग्स.
So, but this is just one thing that I thought that I could mention. You are going to be myself and Dr. David Frawley have a long association which started in 1996 in Atlanta. It so happened that we who had settled, who had been working in USA at that time, and we found that in some of the universities, in particularly in USA, there are what you can call religious departments or other kind of departments, and they teach all sorts of things for different religions. We found that there is really not the right kind of thing which is presented at any time. We were professors and doctors and GBs and all that, but we were not basically in the field of philosophy and what you can call as the religion of. So we decided that let us try to do something in the right way. And at that time, in 1996, we organized a conference. I think some of you know that there is a society called World Association for Vedic Studies or those. Anybody, somebody who knew? Okay. This is with respect to that. It was formed in 1996, first in the United States of America. And we held a conference in which 22 countries participated. Yeah, just for me. And then in that case, we formed a group of persons, seven of them. Myself was there, Dr. Frawley was there, Subhash Kant was there, Professor Vajpayee was there, and all that. And we decided that we'll form this society with the name World Association for Vedic Studies. So what I wanted particularly to say is that he is one of the founders of the World Association for Vedic Studies, which has advanced.
Please be very brief. Please ask the question and introduce yourself and who will pose this question.
Sir, in your speech, you speak about Maratha, Rajput and Kokar. I want to know what is Kokar or who is Kokar? The books are Kokar. In your speech, sir.
Kokar.
So what you
were saying, they were very warlike people.
And Kokars, by 1919, Multan Kingdom was established, Islamic Kingdom in Multan. And they captured Lahore also by 10 something. Do 300 years se the entire Punjab was under the Muslim rule. But Jasrath Kokar, he revolted and he freed Lahore and right up to the borders of India. He threw and he established, he threw out the Umedi, whatever. So Jasrath naam tha, Jasrath naam tha. And then, after that, in the late 14th century, the entire Kokar community, entire needs with exceptions, they were converted to Islam. And it was a great loss. However, You may know that Muhammad Gauri was stabbed by a cooker when he was very lucky, they say, somewhere near Hisar. So, cookers, abhi bhi milenge aapko. Cookers abhi bhi milenge. But you know, it was the originating community from Jainam district. I mentioned it because, you know, they carried on a struggle like the Jats. Jats were originally in Sindh. From Sindh, then they moved to this area. And they carried on the struggle. They carried on the struggle.
Jats and Kukur is the same thing.
No, not the same. They are different communities.
Islamic jihad, like, is very meticulous, and Christian evangelism is continued with the international in Shabrimala case. We think we quickly covered the influence of feel good, you know, but Shabrimala, there is still twisting. You know, like human equality with the traditions of a temple, which is the cradle for 5 crore Hindus in Kerala and in South India. So, still we are not united. What we are discussing is very basic. It's like madrasa level thing. And they are very clear. They killed Kamlesh Tiwari the same day this Ayodhya thing is closed in the court to create riots. And what we are doing here, we are just, we don't even want to have a scratch on our skin. So this is the question, like, what is the way forward? We don't have our war instincts, we don't have nothing, like.
As we said, we have survived, we'll survive. What's one line formula from all three of you and my learned friends? How do we change our mindset from survive to thrive?
Sir, my question is to Dr. Kapil Kapoor, please. You said that Hindu himself is the culprit for all these disasters. Yes. In our constitution, there is section 28, 29, and 30. These three sections, they are the root cause of the problem which we are facing today. So, what we are doing, in last 70 years, we did nothing about them. So please, can we do something? Is there any movement against them? Thank you.
My question is also related to the question. So I come from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. So I wanted to know, how can we bring in the works of Ram Swaroopji and Sridhar Guruji within these communities where even their names are not spoken of? In libraries, we don't find their works at all. So how do we bring about their work in such locations?
This question is for Dr. David Kolanji. I want to know, where do they start reading? I mean, you mentioned the level of consciousness part. I can't really understand. So, where should they start reading over?
Mera question hai, Kapil Sasa.
सर
मैं इंग्लिश में बात कर रही थी मैं हिंदी में बात कबूर सर से मेरा क्वेश्चन है मेरे रिसर्च मेरा ही बहुत सारे रिसर्च है पहला तो जो अटैक हुआ था हमारा एजुकेशन पॉलिसी उसके बाद फॉर्मेशन ऑफ पोलिटिकल कांग्रेस पॉलिटिकल एरा तीसरा हुआ कि सेकुलरिज्म जो सेकुलर हिंदू मरीज हैं मैं उनको एक पैशन नहीं मानता तो सेक्युलरिज्म का जो शब्द है संविधान में घुसाया गया है किसी तरह से वो एक कंस्पायरेसी था मैं मानता हूँ कि वो इमरजेंसी लगा करके तो ये इस धर्म धर्म प्रिंसिपल का कोई धर्म नहीं है पूरे वर्ल्ड में कोई इसका फॉलोअर कोई है नहीं थर्ड कंसेप्ट है नहीं फोर्थ कंसेप्ट है नहीं क्रिश्चियनिटी इस्लाम और हिंदुइज्म वैदिक संस्कृत ये धर्म प्रिंसिपल को लगाया गया इसको इसकी अगेंस्ट में हमें क्या कर रहे हैं इसको हटाने के लिए हमें कुछ किया जा रहा है कि ये सबसे बड़ा फैक्टर है हिंदू को धर्म इसके बारे में
सर स्कॉलर है निर्मल मेरा क्वेश्चन डॉक्टर कपूर से है सर जैसे शिक्षा पद्धति या शिक्षा पॉलिसी जैसे आपने बोला उसका प्रभाव पहले कम हुआ करता था क्योंकि संयुक्त परिवार होता था शिक्षा केवल स्कूल में ही नहीं मिलती थी बल्कि जो मौलिक शिक्षा है वो घर में दिया है, लेकिन अब हमारे पास और भी बड़ा क्वेश्चन है क्योंकि हमारी न्यूक्लियर फैमिलीज हैं, मोस्ट ऑफ द हस्बैंड्स एंड वाइफ बोथ आर वर्किंग, और जो बच्चे हैं वो स्कूल में ही शिक्षा पाते हैं और या तो जो मेट्स वगैरह हैं वो सिखाते हैं। तो इस मुद्दे को एड्रेस करने के लिए शिक्षा पद्धति में कुछ अभी सुधार की जरूरत है आपके
संविधान धर्मनिरपेक्ष है तो ये अल्पसंख्यकवाद के अंतर्गत आता है। अल्पसंख्यकवाद जाति के धर्म के नाम पर अल्पसंख्यकवाद क्यों चल रहा है जब हमारा देश धर्मनिरपेक्ष है? अल्पसंख्यकवाद तो लोग समाज फर्म थी।
One question was about Islamic jihad and evangelism and relevance regarding its Sabrimala mandate and the issue of religions. That was posted.
Yes, that's the essence of the whole thing. It wants to destroy the Hindu culture. You do that through taking down the most commonly used in Mahara temple and deity, and then you turn the community against itself. So this is all part of the of a strategy that has been specifically devised for Tiger Kerala. It's coming from the Kerala government itself. It's aligned with missionaries. It's aligned with jihadists, and you should know that these strategies are going on there and being able to protect these places in advance. The struggle is going on. I think the courts may make a better decision in the future, but don't underestimate what these groups are doing. All Hindu temples and Hindu festivals and Hindu events are going to be challenged at a cultural level, on an ecological level, because this is the strength of the Hindu Dharma.
There are three questions which I can jump together. One was about the constitutional summits and all. Another was about secular religion, what should be done about it. And then, why is there minorities in a secular country? So,
yes, India's secularism, of course, is unique. And it is the secularism becomes the rule of the minority, even though democracy is the rule of the majority. And you have to understand, Hindus were under foreign rule and colonial rule, and once they become gain their own rule, it said majoritarianism is back. When were Hindus ever practicing majoritarianism under all these particular issues? No, the secularism has to be thrown out. It's protecting minorities, giving advantage to minority religions is not secularism. It doesn't happen in the Western world. It only happens in the Indian context. Constitution has to be interpreted properly. All religions should be treated properly. There are other issues going on. Hindu Dharma is more than a religion, but it cannot be reduced and taken its rights of religion away from it. And Hindus have to protest and take a stand, and they cannot simply be quiet in the things they have to do.
You see, question that I said that we are guilty ourselves, but then we are bound by a constitution. That's the point. We have provision with the government, which discriminate against us. That's what the S.S. Yagamu will be talking about, loaded governments against the Hindus. Loaded governments. So,
hello.
So, I think, you know, this constitution itself is alien to our culture. We have to understand this. And it is a patch-up work. By the way, it was not written by American. American ji was the chief editor. And American ji's one very important suggestion was not accepted.
Yes.
He led 50 members of the constituent committee and proposed to them that Sanskrit should be made the official language of India. And Sanskrit was really never even not really even for Hindi. So this constitution is a combination of American constitution, the British unwritten conventions, and the socialism of Sidney and Beatrice Webb. Ye jod jad ke banaya. It is alien because it starts with the assumption that India is not a nation and we have to make it into a nation. That is why, because they were also the product of this education. Nation is a European 19th century concept, post Bismarck. एक धर्म एक जाति और एक भाषा वो नेशन होती है. ये तो हमारा है कि हमारा तो नेशन ही नहीं है, तो नेशन बनानी है तो कैसे करेंगे. एक एक लैंग्वेज देश टूक दी नीड देयर वाज नो नीड टू मेंशन लैंग्वेज इन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन. देश चल नहीं रहा था वैसे, इनसे अंग्रेजों से पहले भी कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन से पहले भी चल रहा था. कम्युनिकेशन भी हो रहा था, ट्रेड भी हो रहा था, गवर्नेंस भी हो रही थी. सो उन्होंने एक लैंग्वेज उस वक्त पॉलिटिकली इंपॉर्टेंट लैंग्वेज थी हिंदी उसको बना दिया. दस साल पांच साल साल में जो उनको समझ आया उन्होंने पांच चार बसें जलाई पत्थर मारे तो फिर अंग्रेजी को एसोसिएट बना दिया. नाउ डी ज्योरे हिंदी इज द ऑफिशियल लैंग्वेज, इंग्लिश इज एसोसिएट बट डी फैक्टो इंग्लिश इज द ऑफिशियल लैंग्वेज एंड हिंदी इज द एसोसिएट. उसके बाद कन्नड़ मराठी वालों ने कहा कि हमारी भाषाओं का इतिहास तो अंग्रेजी से भी पुराना, हम क्या है तो शेड्यूल 8 बना दिया. उसमें 12 लैंग्वेजेस थी, अब 23 है और 37 एप्लीकेशन पड़ी है, है ना. सो यू सी इट्स एन इल थॉट. अमेरिकन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में इन ऑल दीज इयर्स 15 अमेंडमेंट हुई है 250 साल, हमारी 100 से ऊपर हो चुकी है. तो एक कमीज का इमेजिन करो कि हमने एक कमीज सिलवाई, अब उसमें पैचेस लगाए हैं, तो इट इज टाइम टू बाई ए न्यू शर्ट. Secondly, why should minorities have the right to educate people in their own system? But the majority has no right to set up its own school. Why only Hindu temples are controlled by the government? Why? And money raised from big Hindu temples is used for anti-Hindu purposes. Why should it? No, as a government said, Hindus as such protest. But Hindus don't protest because these days Hindus are having a good time. आराम से पैसा कमाओ, बच्चों को अच्छी तरह पढ़ाओ, 10-12 लाख का पैकेज दिला दो, है ना. This investment for us, अमेरिका में हिंदू इंडिया में हिंदू अब थोड़ा सोचने लग गए हैं कि तो हम मारकाट शुरू हो गई, अदरवाइज वो आइडियल था. तो इसी वी आर वेरी We have lost a sense of commitment to our country. देश बहुत देर में आता है. इतना हमें रूलर का कॉम्प्लेक्स हो गया कि जो हमारी भी प्रॉपर्टी कॉमन लो कॉल प्रॉपर्टी है उसको हम एनिमी प्रॉपर्टी मानते. गवर्नमेंट इज द एनिमी. दिस वी हैव कल्टीवेटेड ओवर 1000 इयर्स. बस में बैठे होते हैं ना लोग, एक पेज ढीला हो उसे और घुमा के और ढीला कर देते हैं. कोई अगर जरा सा होगा फट रहा होगा उसे उंगली लगाया एनिमी प्रॉपर्टी. हमारी बसों की आदत देखते हैं कोई मेंटेन नहीं, मेंटेलिटी इज नॉट. तो इसको क्या करना है? आई टेल यू द ओनली थिंग, इट इज अवर एजुकेशन व्हिच इज टोटली रिस्पॉन्सिबल एंड सो लॉन्ग एज द एजुकेशन. बिकॉज जब आप अपनी भाषा को पढ़ाएंगे प्रांतीय भाषाओं में तो आपका प्रांतीय साहित्य जो है, प्रांतीय जो लोक साहित्य है, लोक कलाएं हैं, वो उसमें आएंगी. और वो सारी लोक कलाएं, लोक साहित्य, लोक भाषाएं जो है वो भारतीय संस्कृति से परिपूर्ण है. अंग्रेजी तो टोटली डिवॉइड है. इसमें तो आपको उल्टा ही सिखाया जाएगा. हमारे बच्चे भी पढ़े आगे अपना अभी आएगी बस आप देखना कैसे रेवोल्यूशन नहीं होती किसी चीज में. अच्छा और दूसरे धर्मों में भी मास स्केल पे सब कुछ होता है और उससे प्रदूषण नहीं होती. दिवाली के पटाखों से होती है, होली के रंग से होती है, इन चीजों से होती है. हम लोग सब सेक्युलरिज्म एंड सोशलिज्म वर इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन 1975 अंडर एमरजेंसी कंडीशन. आई थिंक देयर शुड बी अ मूव डिमांड I have tried several times, many places. Sir, why don't we tell the government that either you have control over the religious places or other things, of other religion,
yeah,
or you leave our temples first? Why do you? Why is it? Abhi dekhe, ek aur chakkar bhi hai. हमारी कमजोरी अभी राम मंदिर ट्रस्ट बनेगा ना, आप देख लेना क्या होगा, ऑलरेडी शुरू हो गया. मेरा नाम आ जाए, मेरा नाम आ
जाए,
चरित्र चरित्र की प्रॉब्लम है.
Surviving, you can't think of surviving. There's only flourishing and expanding. If you're not expanding, you're going to be.
Yeah.
So get out of the survival mentality.
Yes.
And also recognize the value of all the Sanatana Dharma. Everybody in the world is taking a yoga or Veda, something from India, and yet they're not giving credit to the tradition that has founded it. Or opposing India while they're better. Even Hillary Clinton politically opposes India. She takes yoga classes. She does all these things. You have to expand. And you also, again, you have to not only recognize your enemy, but recognize your strengths. Don't always be defending yourself. Expand. Take your knowledge, take your tradition, share it, expand it, move, explore it. Face your enemies, dialogue, critique, and move beyond. You have to just move into that active mode.
श्री जगन आंध्र प्रदेश के चीफ मिनिस्टर ने तेलुगु मीडियम स्कूलों में बैन कर दिया. इट्स गोइंग टू बी ओनली इंग्लिश मोड एंड दिस इज ए स्टेप टू फैसिलिटेट कन्वर्जन. एंड ए क्रिश्चियन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑफ अमेरिका वेलकम द इलेक्शन ऑफ जगन एज द चीफ मिनिस्टर ऑफ आंध्र बिकॉज ही इज द सन ऑफ वाईएसआर. Many people discovered the Christian YSR of Bahrain. And Jagan is a Christian. So he has banned Telugu medium. And Andhras, Mahabharata, they are mentioned as many variant people. Andhras. They are lined up Muslim. Because why? E-E-E. English education.
Right.
You can say that you don't. आप एकदम देखो एक साल में
कंटिन्यू हो जाएगा
above a larger number of schools and in the university with the highest level, we set up the syllabus. And the syllabus way you have to include something and then you know it percolates down. The freedom for it of a teacher, if you one step can be, give the teacher the freedom to teach what he wants to teach in a subject. I must say, for all that evil that JMU is undergoing or has undergone, I was in JMU. It was possible for me to teach Panini's Ashtadhyayi in MA English. MA English. Can you imagine? And for 6 months. Ashtadhyayi is not taught even in Sanskrit departments. I was able to teach it because I had the freedom to do that. But otherwise, the system is so hard. And also, teachers do not like to introduce things which they themselves do not know. Because that means work for them. Their character, fundamental point is charitra. Wo pehle kisi written bada achha kaha ke, ab to schoolon se seekhte hain. Pehle to ghar mein seekhte the. मदर वाला भी फर्स्ट टीचर. अब मदर बेचारी मोबाइल कान में लगा हुआ है, बच्चे को ड्रैग करके स्कूल में चढ़ा रही है और सारा दिन वहां रहती है, फिर शाम को घर आती है थकी थकाई पर लड़का भी देखो उसको तो ना उसको आता है, दादियों को आता था. और दादियां तो अब रिडंडेंट हो गई एक्सेप्ट व्हेन दे आर नीडेड एज अ वेट एंड वेट सर्वेंट इन अमेरिका. अब दादी को किराया देके बुला देते हैं.
अपने वापस
सर लास्ट क्वेश्चन ऑन अबाउट कॉन्शियसनेस अबाउट कॉन्शियसनेस
हाउ टू वेयर टू स्टार्ट
हाउ टू
लर्न
टू स्टार्ट दिस कॉन्शियसनेस consciousness is the main subject of the Vedanta. It's the main subject of gurus, modern gurus, Sri Aurobindo, Swami Swami Chinmayananda. It's a very good place to study the Vedanta and the consciousness, Swami Dayananda, Maharsha Vidya. So there are, of course, this Chinmaya mission is also here. So there are adequate resources for that, but it requires some sort of sadhana. It requires understanding that information is not enough, information is not intelligence. Unless we cultivate our own deeper introspection and self-awareness, then we can be confused by all of these external factors. So we say there should be the introduction of Vedanta into the schools, or at least into the families and into the temples. And a reclamation, as here, restoration of mind into intelligence and deeper awareness.
Thank you very much, sir. I always say कि अगर आप इस चीज को अपनी शब्दावली में इसका कॉन्शियसनेस का मतलब है चेतन चेतन या चैतन्य चैतन्य चित्त जो हमारा थ्योरी है रोहित सर की चित्त चित्त से चेतन पंजाबी में चेतना अभी भी वर्ब है आत्मज्ञान आत्मज्ञान आत्म साक्षात्कार जो जैनी लोग कहते हैं प्रत्यक्ष प्रत्यक्ष जो होता है जो जो विजुअल सामने देखता है प्रत्यक्ष अकॉर्डिंग टू जैन फिलॉसफी वो नहीं है जो आपको बाहर दिखता है उनका प्रत्यक्ष वो है जो आपको अंदर दिखता है सो आईज बंद करके देखना और उसमें जो माइंड की फोकस एकाग्रता सब यूज है वंस यू हैव द एकाग्र चित्त तो इतना वन पॉइंटेड कॉन्शियसनेस एकाग्र चित्त उस वक्त देन द अंडरस्टैंडिंग यू रीच whether you resolve the subject of the instrument and all that, then becomes very important. Sir ne kaha ki pura Vedanta philosophy jo hai darshan isi ke bare mein hai Aurobindo ji ki writing iske bare mein
there's an interesting statement in Yoga Vasishtha that we must move from the chittatva nature of chitta to chittatva tatva of chitta Meaning, and that's what the West doesn't have. They don't know how to move beyond the mind to direct awareness. They don't have a samadhi pramana. They don't have the sanyama. That deeper intelligence is the basis of all of greater insight.
Thank you very much. Again, we are very grateful to Dr. Derek Foley. Shastriji, you give us your time, precious time, during this short India visit. And I hate to address us on such an important issue, but it was a massive contribution of absolute humanity. I am also grateful to our chairman, Professor Kapil Kapoor. Thank you very much, sir.